No planet side?
Doesn't look like it.
Down. There we go. Take two. Take two, Mario Brothers. Competition beyond all competitions. Right now, Kleisath versus Boyer. Head to head. Knock down, drag out amazingness. Are you ready to be destroyed? Who will win? I have my money on one of them. I'm not going to tell you who, because I want to see both of them play excellent. It looks like Kleisath is getting, he's a little slower underway, but we've got Boyer already driving ahead. Let's check his score right now. Actually, it looks like he's going to restart. That was just a little bit of a warm-up game. Welcome, everybody, to Elite Lounge Live. Thank you for joining us. If you were here for Game Talk Live, you are in for a real treat. Stay here for the next 7 hours. We are going to be watching some serious... These are two of the best Mario Brothers players in the world. They play Mario Brothers Arcade. Now, this is way before you with your namby-pamby Nintendo controllers and your fancy cartridges. This was the legit, real deal arcade playing where you dominated your friends with one quarter. Could you beat them with one quarter? I don't know. I bet these two gentlemen here, Kleisath and Boyer, could definitely beat you with one quarter. But the real truth and real competition comes down to if they can beat each other. I'm going to try and get some visuals up here for myself because I want to enjoy this as much as you guys are going to. I personally have played the game. It is difficult, as most arcade games are, compared to today's games. I'm giving you a hard time. Today's games, there are some difficult games, so don't think that just because you play your Calls of Duties and your Titanfalls that you couldn't hang with these guys. But I don't think you could. There it is. Simo, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Old school man, going back to your roots. Yes, you should be going back to your roots for this incredible game because it is awesome. I'm going to bring up the stream here for myself to see. Who, me? No, he's not asking me. I lied on that one. How's everybody doing today? Are you ready for some Mario versus Mario? A Mario blast off? Yes, Wolf's Den. I appreciate that. I would put. Well, let me get back to you on that, okay? What Kleisath and Boyer would like to have promoted. I'm just checking here.
You know, if they're streaming this, correct?
Hearing myself there.
Yeah, I don't think you can hear yourself.
Alright, here we go.
Xander.
Looks like... Well, we should... in honor of this arcade feat, I am wearing I'm wearing my Pac-Man Nom 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 shirt. Thank you, Cad Despira. Yes. Wishing good luck to these fine fine men. I'm excited to see them.
Let me get back to you on that, okay? What Kleisath lawyer would like to have promoted.
They're streaming.
Hey, I got a request. I can't hear you guys right now, but Stephen, Mr. Kleisath, I believe you are on our camera one, and I think we're hearing some of your audio coming from our stream. So it's.
I'll bring it back.
Okay. How's the weather in Australia, Walker?
Here we go. Skype is back. Hello, Skype.
Oh,
Skype,
hi.
Gentlemen.
Hey, Xander, just curious, what happened to PlanetSide?
Hey, it looks like Sir Knuckles is in. World-class knucklehead, I would bet. Yes. Oh, what happened to PlanetSide? A little bit of snafu in the schedule. We're jumping right into the Mario off. Very excited.
Probably do daylight savings.
That was very smart. Now, this is coming from a Mario Brothers noob, right? For those of you who don't know the game or who are going to get into the game, I really like seeing what Steven did there. He took the two Koopas. I mean, essentially, they're Koopas. But he took the turtles on either side, creating a little kind of a cage, if you will. And then down came the crabs. He used his POW to flip them all over, and then he got up there and took them all down. Very smart.
Very smart. Now, this is coming from a Mario Brothers move, right? For those of you who don't know the game, or who are going to get into the game, I really like seeing what Steven did there.
Just had dinner. That sounds like a good thing to do, is have dinner. I'm gonna switch over here. Looks like Boyer is Boyer's getting a better camera angle here. I'm gonna use our team page and switch over. Looks like he's at 60,300. We've got Stephen Kleisath is already at 109,000. So this is an exciting Mario off. Look at that. That's a nice technique there. The fireball will not hit you, staying right there. I wonder if we could get either one of the Stevens to Skype into one of our Skype channels, so we could hear them and talk to them live while it's going. That would be pretty great. Appreciate it. Sounds like, from what I'm hearing from my tech support here, from Adam Rady, is that you muted our stream, which is good, so that we didn't kind of have the overflow. Whose game? Stephen Kleisath is the main view, but it's gonna auto switch back and forth. So you're gonna see Kleisath and Boyer. It looks like Kleisath's screen is the full straight on MAME view, and Mr. Boyer's stream is the kind of angled view of the screen. So. A Dracula off. Nice. But I think you would have to wear teeth, a cape, and the appropriate, you know, maybe some blood. You'd have to have a little bit of blood coming out of, like, the corners of your mouth. See, to show you what kind of a noob I am at the game, I have not seen this far into the game. So the speed at which now they're coming is pretty awesome. We're having a little bit of a slowdown today if you're watching on our team page, EliteLoungeLive.com. Let me know if you're having any buffering issues, what's going on.
I was having lots of buffering issues.
You were. Sorry, Lurker, that is set in the schedule planet side and that we're not. I know you're a little disappointed. I can see. Wipe away those tears, my friend.
Oh, yeah.
Your hair is getting very long, too. It's not. It's kind of extending outwards. It's pretty amazing.
I don't know what I'm doing with it. I need to find a lawnmower.
Yeah, you could definitely have a large. You could have a fro. You could be a fro lurker.
Yeah, I can work with that. Audio here is still cut out. Yeah, we got audio with anybody else at the moment? Well, since I can't hear anything, I guess I'll put in a bit of a. So this is Mario Brothers. It is a platform arcade published and developed by Nintendo in 1983.
Yes, you're reading about Mario Brothers.
Yeah, just a Wikipedia page.
Yeah, it's an awesome game. You know, when you say Mario Brothers, when I say Mario Brothers, what do you think of, Lurker?
I think of the Super NES one myself.
Okay, you think immediately of the Super NES one. Others think of the NES version, which is the original, right? The quote-unquote original, Super Mario Brothers. But this was way before that, and definitely is awesome. You know, you can see the similarity in Mario. He didn't evolve too much going into Super Mario Brothers.
Well, he was originally in Donkey Kong, wasn't he?
Yes, well, he has been a staple of Nintendo World for quite some time.
It was developed by Shigeru Miyamoto.
His mic cut out? Oh, yes, my mic, orbital obs. I muted my mic for a sec because I had some little business to talk about. Already at 173,000. Stephen Kleisath is, and if we check over on the progress with Stephen Boyer, we've got.
Yes, you're reading about Mario Brothers. Yeah, it's an awesome game. You know, when you say Mario Brothers, when I say Mario Brothers, what do you think? Okay, you think immediately the Super NES one. Others think of the NES version. The original, right? The quote-unquote Super Mario Brothers. But this was way before that, and definitely is awesome. You know, you can see the similarity in Mario. He didn't evolve too much going into Super Mario Brothers. Yes, well, he
has been... is that 70? Okay, we are back. Thanks. We're having a little bit of a buffering issue. Some weird things happening. Stuff's happening. So we wanna take care of it here for a moment. So as it loads up back up for me, yeah, you don't want to turn away because already Stephen is at 236,600, just like that. And if we check back over with Stephen Boyer, he is at 137,540. My goodness, these guys are cruising along. The Stevens battling it out. Wow, nice. Look at those. For those of you who have never made it very far in this game, this is some very cool gameplay to witness.
You don't want to turn away because already Stephen is at 236,600.
Thank you.
Just like that. And check back over.
Mario does have a lot of problems, zombie bait, if you think about it. And thank you for the nickname Zando. And is that like Zando Calrissian? He's plain evil. I don't think so. He just is constantly being attacked.
Xander.
Yes.
This is the picture that Kyle Katarn sent on Link.
Okay, let me see. Thank you for putting it up so I could see.
Basically states that Mario used to have a gun.
Mario had a gun? From what game? What does it say?
During much of development, the controls were A to shoot bullets, B to dash, and up on the control pad to jump. In the end, we realized that being able to shoot at the fireballs you want while running gave Mario too much of an advantage, so instead we had it so you shoot only one fireball when you start running. That freed up the A button,
right.
And we made that the jump button. I really wanted to have A be the action button and make you press up to jump, but it definitely worked out better for Mario in the end.
Marky D, you're saying that Boyer is at 244? It's possible I'm behind in what I'm looking at, unless I have them swapped. I'm going to double check here. Okay, I see what you're saying. Yes, I have it switched. Camera one, I had it switched. So, got it. So I had it wrong. Stephen Boyer is the full screen, which is what we are looking at right now. And he is at 268. Thank you for the correction, Marky D. I appreciate that. I had it swapped. So Stephen Kleisath is the angled view, which you can see, which is the other view. Zombie bait. But really, it's okay, isn't it? Isn't it acceptable to kill? I don't think of them as being killed. I just think of what happens is they're just bumped down to another level. See? And look, if you watch this, he just kicked the crab into the water. The crab wants to be in the water anyway. Have they been playing? Quinigami, they have been playing. They started at 6 p.m. our time. Which is now 6:24, so they've been paying about 30 minutes. Looks like now Stephen Kleisath is up to 217,000. And we have Stephen Boyer is at 200, almost 300. He's almost hit 300,000. Have any of you watching, any of you out there, have you, what's your experience with Mario Bros? I'm getting blown up here.
And look, if you watch this, he just kicked the crap out of me.
See, you only, you have to use wisely your POWs. Looks like Stephen Boyer is really, really taken off with Stephen Kleisath coming closely behind. He's quickly catching up. 235. He's got 235 right now, doing very well. Make sure you're on our team page so you can be swapping back and forth here. Excuse me. Oh yeah, they'll easily reach a million before nine. Who in the lounge? Who in the lounge right now could get me the info? What's the world record here?
I'll look.
Thanks, Wolf. You're swell.
What's the game called again? I'm kind of zoned out at the moment.
That's all right.
Believe Mario Brothers.
Mario Bros. Yeah, Mario Brothers. Just Mario Brothers Arcade.
Okay.
Actually, while you look that up, I have here the official video game and pinball book of world records, third edition. So it's possible that it's changed since this one, but I could look it up under arcade emulation. Oh, whoa, I turned right to it. No joke. Now, this was in 2005, so this obviously has been defeated. But score was 782,260 from George Strain. Totally, that just seems crazy that it's... Because these two Mario Brothers players, Stephen Kleisath and Stephen Boyer, are going to destroy that.
How do you know?
Well, it's been 30 minutes, and Stephen Boyer is at 373,330. So, pretty much guaranteed. I mean, he's already halfway there. And let's check in with Stephen Kleisath here. He's at 297,700, so he's going to hit the 300,000 mark in no time, handily taking care of the Koopas. I'm going to grab this laptop. I want to look up all the character names. Does anybody know, who can name all the characters here that you go up against? It seems maybe we lost some of the classic gamers, like Richie Knuckles was in here a moment ago, Cat Despera, I don't know if they're still around and would want to weigh in here.
Lurker left, by the way.
Lurker did leave. Sorry, Lurker. Thanks for hanging out.
I think he was mad that you guys weren't doing plant site, but...
Nah, he wasn't that mad. Dan Man. Hey, Dan Man. What's going on? Yeah, here we go. Gameplay. I'm going to check out the... Here we go. Let's see.
Finding a lot on Super Mario Brothers.
Well, yes, of course. Oh, interesting. You actually can get this on your 3DS. There we go. Thank you, Marky D. I knew somebody would chime in there. Thanks, Marky. So Marky D chimed in. World record is 4,678,440 by Tom Fotava in 2009. Yeah, damn man. Marky D posted it.
Do you think they'll beat that?
Now, Marky D, is that on? That's on actual cabinet, right? An official game, not emulator. Here we go. Permafrost Rick. The gray blue hopping enemies are fighter flies, and the crabs are sidewinders. So there's the fighter flies, which they have Darth Vader teeth, if you haven't noticed, which makes them even more intimidating. I mean, even the sidewinders get Darth Vader teeth when they're angry. Marky D said second place is 3.48 million. Yowzers. Yeah, Dan Man. Yeah, there we go. Dan Man and Marky D cleared it up for us. Thank you very much. It was on the arcade cabinet, so.
Do you think they'll beat that there at the lounge?
Say again?
Do you think they'll beat that record at the lounge?
You mean what they're doing right now?
Yeah.
Well, we're gonna see. We're gonna see what they can get to. This head-to-head is pretty awesome. So the sidesteppers. So the fighter flies and the sidesteppers.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm glad that the stream is happening. I'm Jennifer Zhang, if this is your first time tuning in.
Hi, Jen.
Hi. We're watching the Mario Off, as we've so dubbed it, with two very, very, very proficient Mario players. I'm actually a little taken aback because I shouldn't be on camera because I had a nose surgery, so I'm a little bit busted up right now. But I'm covering for just a few minutes while Xander goes and takes care of some business. So anyway, just keep your eye on the awesome gameplay. Pay no attention to me or my disfigurement.
You look fine.
Aw, thank you.
Emma loves you.
Aw, thank you. Very cool. So you know what's funny? This isn't the first version of Mario that I played. I played Mario Brothers. How many of you had this as your first Mario experience and not the Super Mario Brothers on the NES? Hey, Dan Man, how's it going?
So how are you feeling, Jen?
Better and better every day. Like, today it's mostly just like centralized pressure in the middle of my face because I've got these really tight bandages holding everything together.
Yeah.
Yeah. How you doing?
I'm holding in there.
I like your appropriately themed mushroom hat.
Yeah, and I've got written across here is Know Your Roots.
Oh, it's funny. That's rad. You came dressed for the occasion. He's making the rest of you guys look bad, just so you guys know.
Well, I actually had a Super Mario Brothers shirt, but I can't find it.
Oh, dude. Mario's eyes in this game are terrifying. It's like he's done just like an entire mountain of blow.
Is it like that Esper picture that they use on Game Talk Live?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know the one you're talking about.
I'll show you. I've got it.
Truffle hat? Is that the appropriate thing? Is it actually a truffle and not a mushroom? No, because it's the Mushroom Kingdom, yo. Don't try to confuse me. No, he's giving me some cash. For the hose. For the hose that I ordered for him.
Jen.
What's that?
This is Esper.
Oh, it's terrifying. Immediately remove that from my sight. Oh, it's stolen a piece of my soul already.
They got another one that they use on Game Talk Live as well, where his eyes are bleeding.
Oh, Jesus. So SD0 says, that's not Mario 64, and attributes it to the quote to kids today. Indeed. Yeah, this one is tough. Hey, Cat, how's it going? Oh, don't look at me. I'm just figured. I'm covering for Xander here. He's hosting this really cool marathon, or not marathon, this gameplay tonight as I recuperate in my office because my nose is about to fall off my face after a surgical procedure. How you doing, Kat?
Are you feeling any better though, Jen?
Yeah, better every day. It's manageable now. It was manageable maybe starting from Thursday this week, so. Danman says Mario was high as F in this game. Look at his eyes. He's been up for days just doing so much blow. And then by the time he did the NES version, his eyes were back to a normal person. A normie's eyes.
You kind of figure he was in the Mushroom Kingdom.
Yeah, there you go. He's doing shrooms. Oh! Why, thank you for noticing us, D-Zero. Getting a lot of lag on the video script. Yeah, so Permafrost Rick, there we go. I almost called you Permafro. Permafrost Rick, that's what Xander and Radio are trying to figure out right now with some of the tech issues. No, I don't think they're going for a world record, but these two that are playing are exceptionally good at it, and they can each cross over a million points handily with this game. Yep, the arcade version. Oh. Yeah, it catches it. I went outside and it was like, nope, going back inside. I got it at a thrift shop. It was like $4. I'm not sure. I have no idea. You know, I have a theory that it has something to do with our internet, but everyone keeps telling me no. Jace keeps telling me no. So.
Yeah, because our internet's killing it. But
I wonder if it's Twitch.
Mm-hmm. It might be Twitch, but I've been watching some other streams at home, and I don't really see. I'm gonna go get paid. No, I'm just kidding. One sec.
That's 26 for the food.
No, you don't need it.
Yes. No, because.
Five sixty-three is where he topped out. Shell creepers, they're called. There you go. Nobody said that. Shell creepers and sidewinders. Shell creepers, sidewinders, and fighter flies. What are the little icicles called? There we go. He's at 485. So we're going to see. Are we going to go round by round? Is that how we're doing it between Stephen Boyer and Stephen Kleisath? So the first, I'm going to take note of this. We're just going to go round one. Are we going just for at the end of the evening, the top score? That could be it. But we also could do it round by round. So he got 560, 563, 150, and he's starting up again. So we'll watch, we'll see, we'll keep track of Stephen Kleisath here and see what he is able to end with. I do not Legion, but I recently got it to try it out. You have a piece of ice that moves around and then freezes the platform. That's slip ice. Right, permafrostric, the slip ice, I do see that. But see that little guy. What's the guy going around? What's he called? Oh my gosh, test your skill where you have to go by memory. Nice job. Well done. If it's a match game, then it is round by round. Sure. Don't worry, you're okay. It's just the guy. Well, Retroper, sidestepper, you're saying? He's at 5:30. 5:31. It only has 32,000 more to get in order to be ahead of where Stephen Boyer was on his first game.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, my name is Lal. How's it going? Thanks for joining us. Fighterflies would be a pretty good band name. Zombie Bait, yes. Steven Boyer ended his game and restarted, so he's on his second game. Rhett Roper is one of the Mario Elite. Explain yourself, Permafrost Rick, or Rhett Roper. Please tell us about your Mario Elite-ness. And if any of you want to Skype in, we have 1, 2, 4, 5, 7, and 8 open right now. You can Skype in and chat with us. There we go. Cheetah30P is letting us know. Sidestepper, Fighterfly, Slip Ice, and Shell Creeper. That's it. So Slip Ice was the name of the little iceberg guy. That's cool. Yes, Mason, get in there. My mom knew a writer. He always wore vests, and whenever she or other people like saw him for the first time, he would open his vest and he would say, "Get in here," and want you to come up and hug him inside of his vest. It's weird. So where are we at here? Let's check in with Stephen Kleisath. He's at 561-800. He's got to get past the 563-150 to take the first game. Looks like he just did it. 577-800. Congrats. Passed up Stephen Boyer on the first round, first game. In our spectacular of spectaculars, Mario off. The shell creepers, when you get up in those levels, they want to talk to you. I want to talk to you. My name is Xander. I'm one of the hosts here as with Adam Rady, Jennifer Zhang, and Matt Hiscox has joined our team. And he is off today, but Jennifer is around as well as Adam Rady. We make up Elite Lounge Live along with Jace Hall, whose brain put some things together and made this all happen. Looks like Stephen Kleisath is doing very well with 600,000. Yeah, Mason, please do. Let's see. And if you have any problems, if it just keeps ringing, let me know, and I can find out. That's right, Retroper. Yeah. You probably know better than I do, but let's see. Trying to remember. Permafrost Rick is saying, trying to remember the name of whom I briefly topped. It had to be late 82 or very early 83. Likely that winter record was only 460,000, then 650-ish. Bumped it to 860. Then next was the first over a million. Yeah, let me, I have the third edition of the Twin Galaxies official video game and pinball world records book. I could take a look for the arcade. Let's see, Mario. There it is, Mario Bros. This is and everyone was saying Vatava currently has the world record, but he back when this came out which was, when was it, 2009, he did not have the world record yet. It was 3.191, and he was second behind Perry Rogers with 3.481. Previous to that, 1.3 was Mauro Rossi and Spencer Quarin at 1.2. That's okay, Mason. Take your time. We're going to be here for a bit. We're not going anywhere. Let's check back in. Looks like Stephen Boyer is at 177,000 in his second game already. Stephen Kleisath is at 649 now. Cleared that level, no problem. At 6:54, very conservative use of the POW. He doesn't go after it at all. So clearly, if you see somebody using the PAL, it seems like it would be filled with nubitry. Okay, there you go. So I just saw one pop of the slip ice, and it breaks apart, and you get 500 points. That's a pretty good deal. Oh, shoot. Lost a life there. Stephen Boyer did. Looks like we're at 682 with Stephen Kleisath, and he is, there we go, working the POW. There he is, watching out. Nice. He's at 686 now. Help Mason out. Okay, Mason, what's going on? Let's see. He said he was trying to. Doesn't matter which. No, it does not. 1, 2. You may as well go into 2 or 7. No problem. You are not the first to put a Z at the beginning of my name. Oh, there we go. Well, that's Kyle Katarn. All right, Kyle Katarn has now taken 4, so do not call 4. I will tell you that much is true. He's already at 700,000, and looks like Stephen Boyer is already at 244 on his second game. So make sure you're on our. I keep clicking call. It keeps telling me an application needs to launch. I tell it to launch it. Stream freezes and nothing happens. Okay, try this, my friend. Open up your Skype app, Mason, and just go to contacts, and you want to type in LoungeLive1, just all one word, LoungeLive1. Now, don't click add contact, but click call, video call, and that should do it. Also, if you're in with Stephen Boyer is, why did my stream go offline? Don't do that to me. See you later, Zombie Bait. Thanks for hanging out. I shouldn't have refreshed, apparently. There we go. Back with 736,000 on Cam 2. If Cam 1 goes offline, you can still see it on the other. Wow. There we go. So 292,000. Stephen Boyer is on his second game. We're going to click back to Stephen Kleisath, who is... Hang on, I'm going to go check. Oh, here it's coming back up. There we go. And back. All right, going back to Cam 2. Here it is. There we are. 739,000 on his first game. Still going. Who knows the extra man problems? Ooh. Who knows when you're given an extra man at what point? Uh-oh. Oh. Just having a little bit of lag here on what I'm watching. No, he's still going strong. 700, rapidly approaching 750,000 points on game number one. Looks like Stephen Boyer is rapidly approaching 300,000 on game two. Well, here we go. Here we go. I can see them up here. Oh. 70 is at 785,000. And looks like we've got Stephen Boyer at 332,000 on his second game.
Check, check. 1, 2. Hello?
Hello. I can hear you.
Yes, does this work? Is this acceptable?
This is very acceptable. Is that Mason?
Yeah, this is Kramer. Hi, this is Mason. What's up?
Hey, how's it going? We'd love to, can you, do you have a webcam? Is it possible to get your video working?
Yeah, I do. I don't know why it's...
Is it possibly X'd out on the app or anything?
No, I've clicked turn it on and
all right.
It doesn't... Oh, wait, maybe it's, yeah, there it goes.
Oh, there it is.
Hey. There you are.
Hey, what's up?
Hey, there you are. Excellent. Hello. So, it looks like Stephen Kleisath is about to hit 800,000 here on his first game. Do you go by Mason? Do you go by Kramer? What do you go by?
I guess Mason or Kramer, whichever you prefer.
Whichever I prefer. Yeah. Well, I'll call you Mason. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
Or what did Kat call you?
I have been to 3 million or so on the NES port of this game, which is a lot easier.
Okay.
I would say, because it doesn't have the falling icicles, the fireballs are less aggressive, sorts of things, but it plays similarly.
Okay, all right. By the way, I like your brick wall and your wall of amazingness that you have over your... You're gracing us with a cool room and a cool sweater, too.
Yeah, well, thanks, man. I really appreciate that. I've got my game collection and my little magic wall of gaming artifacts and weird things.
Excellent, excellent. What's the weirdest one on your wall?
Hang on. Let's see. I have this. My girlfriend made me this. It's a Morimo. It's a little algae ball in a jar of water with some rocks at the bottom.
Wow.
See it.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's tiny. Super tiny.
Yeah, it's cool. And it, like, responds to the presence of people. Like, if you're nearby it, like, bounces up and down. It's really weird. Bunch of Mario stuff that got made. I have a sand dollar. That's kind of neat. Just, like, weird
stuff. So random coolness. I see. Now, what's amazing here to me is that Stephen Kleisath has been going... on one man this for quite a while now, because from my understanding, from what's been said in the chat, you only get one extra bonus life early on. And
I got the max out score on that a couple years ago, the deathless max out thing. And,
excellent.
Did the Mario 3 score recently, but like I found NES sort of as an adult after I had like money to go out and spend on video games that I couldn't get when I was a kid.
Very cool. It was just pointed out in the chat, thank you for pointing that out, Retroper, that phase 98 and then the phase number stops incrementing. So this, he currently Stephen Kleisath is on phase 98, and he's at 894,000 right now. So it should stop going up. Now tell me, in your experience with the version you've played, when the slip ice freezes a platform, are you no longer able to bump the creatures from underneath, or can you still hit them?
You can still hit them, and all my references come from the NES version. Like,
yes,
I say.
Exactly, right.
When the platform is frozen, you can still hit them. But I found there to be a weird sort of timing glitch involving if you try to bump something at exactly the moment that ice creature is freezing the platform,
right,
it won't register the hit every now and then.
Interesting.
And it seems to be like in that exact frame when the platform is like turning into ice.
Okay, all right.
I don't know if that holds true for this, but I bet we could just sort of watch and
yes, exactly. I think we have. I had a question on how to get the slip ice. And it was quickly answered shortly after I saw that we won 19,000 right now, phase 98. And it looks like Stephen Boyer is almost hitting 450,000 points on his second game. Stephen Kleisath, of course, is still on his first game for round one. So it looks like if we're going round by round, he will clearly take round one. And there it was, stuck at phase 98, so it's not going to roll over there. This is a tough game that once you lose your guys, you're stuck with one man, so.
The power box regenerates every couple of boards. I'm not sure, I think every bonus stage.
I would think that you would get, they should have one bonus guy at like a million points, give you a little break.
A lot of games are like that. You just get the one life and then it's a four life game to play the whole thing out.
Yeah.
Because that's assuming you can get to the 20,000 point threshold on a game, that's going to at least half, even half a million. It's just assumed that you can get that, so it's just a four life game naturally.
Well, looks like we're going to see possibly how the mechanic works. If he bumps from underneath,
is that the screen that's in? Is he on the bonus stage now? The one in the middle that I'm watching.
The one currently in the middle is no. The bonus stage is Stephen Boyer.
Okay, so I get the other one.
Yeah, so if you kind of click back and forth, he is now on a bonus stage though. He's at 900. Yeah, he's at bonus stage and 935,000. Stephen Boyer is at 483,000. What you're seeing is Stephen Boyer's in Skype. Yeah, that's who you're seeing.
Cool. Yeah, Google. Hey, what's up, Stephen? Man, you're rocking out. This is a cool game to see.
Yeah. Both Kleisath and Boyer are really doing a great job. Kleisath here on his first game is just killing it with 955,000. Doing great. See how long he can keep it up. Doing very well. Kudos here to Stephen Boyer coming right back with game two, already at 490,000, rapidly approaching where he was for his first game. First game probably was just a good solid warm-up because he still has one extra man years ago, but I don't know if he still is. But yeah, Mappy's a tough game. It's not easy.
I'm an expert to track. Others, though.
I'm gonna.
What else? Elevator action. Remember that?
Oh, elevator action is awesome. That's another great one.
That's hard, man.
It is it's another hard one. I really liked the follow up to it. The graphics were very cool. The elevator action follow up.
Yeah.
Oh, is it? I didn't know they had one.
Yeah, it's super, it's sleek. You know how, obviously blocky the elevator action character is. They made him very kind of sleek with great movement.
It's interesting.
Of course.
I wonder if he's the same spy from Spy Hunter.
Could be. Could very well be. Looks, Stephen Kleisath's doing great with 975. He's just hitting. And you know, Stephen Boyer is answering very quickly with a 524 in his second game, with one man. So that's he could easily have a game as good as this 977,000. Looks like Kleisath is going to hit a million, no problem. We'll see how well he can continue on. Arcade Doctor, you definitely should pull your.
You can work with because your speed isn't that variable. So you have to, like, there's like an economy of movement. Like, I'm not sure. I'm watching, what am I watching? Stevens right now.
Stephen Kleisath's, and he is going to hit a million here.
Yeah.
You heard him there. He said 1 million, baby.
Congratulations, man. That's rad.
1 million points.
Yeah, there's sort of like, and you can hit stuff from below. Like, you can hit it in such a way that it stays right where it is, or you can send it forward a little bit or backwards, and you can, like,
yes,
that to your advantage. I see right at the beginning he's running a pattern where I think they both do it, where you hit the one, it's either a bee or a crab, and you hit it into each other, and the crab turns around in midair. That kind of strategic blockage is like how you work with flow in this game.
Yeah, oh, definitely.
But I mean, like I said, I don't claim to be an expert on the arcade version. I've just spent a lot of time with basically this. I mean, I feel like I could, you know, play this version if I sat down with it on a machine or even on MAME, but I just haven't put the time in. That was a good clear.
That was a very good clear. He's at 1,023,000 right now and still going strong. His comment was, it's all gravy now. So sounds very confident in this game. This is a great first game for him. If we check back with Stephen Boyer, he's at 577, so he's already surpassed his first game, and he still has an extra man. So he's doing very well on his second game. Definitely not sitting down, rest. Yeah, so close down, come right back, call right back, and you'll be fine. Looks like Stinky Weasel Teats has joined, one of our favorite screen names here.
Waiting for the video. There.
There you go, yeah.
Okay, cool.
So Stephen Kleisath doing great, is at 1,051,000. Still just holding strong. We got also Stephen Boyer is back with 615,000 on his second game. Still has an extra man, doing very well. I will be right back.
What's up, guys, in 1337 Lounge. Once again, since you guys can hear me, thanks so much for simulcasting this and taking up me and Stephen Boyer. Love Stephen. Trust me, he'll get over a million tonight before it's all said and done. Right now, you were talking about the scoreboard or the as far as the official scores for this game. Stephen Boyer's number 3 in the world, and I'm number 5 in the world currently in this game, for reference. My personal best is 1.4 million, and Stephen Boyer's personal best is like 2 million, I think, actually, so just for reference. I guess you guys are offline.
No, we're still here, just occasionally little blips here and there, but thanks for hanging in there. Kleisath, you're doing great. I appreciate that. What he just let us know is that Stephen Boyer is 3rd in the world currently, with an over 2 million, and Stephen Kleisath is 5th in the world on this. And he was just expressing his confidence in Stephen Boyer going over a million tonight. And right now, Stephen Kleisath is hitting the 1,086,000 mark, and looks like Stephen Boyer on his second game is at 632,000, doing very well. Still has an extra man, is definitely going to hit a million. We can definitely feel it. But there it is, 1.1 million, doing great.
My stuff.
And 650,000, also looking great.
That is it right there.
Oh, that was it. He ended it. Stephen Kleisath ends his first game with 1,102,890.
So that's my first game, guys. 1,102,890. I'm pretty happy with that. I'm going to take a break for a couple minutes, just get a drink.
This is an interesting game to try to predict the flow for, because not only are you watching out for the wraparound,
yeah,
on the screen, but enemies collide with each other and
right.
switch out. And, like, you see, like, Stephen Boyer's, like, the blue crab coming down the middle switched out because the platform turned to ice, and the coins also act as an object, quote, that would reverse the direction. So it's, like, you have to plan, like, I'll point it out if I see one, like, you have to plan for how things are going to resolve, like, two platforms down from where you are.
Right.
And, like, account for, like, the side flipping. Like,
yes, exactly, place. Exactly.
It's like random-ish, but it's not, because it's got that predictive flow to it. I really like talking about, like, gameplay mechanics and why and how things work the way they do. It caps out the difficulty at a low-timer ice
really?
Platform version of the bonus level, and this one has one that makes them vanish like
interesting,
that.
Interesting.
It's like I said, the NES is just overall a little bit more simple, a little bit easier than this.
Right.
And the rounds, I think, repeat in a different sort of way. I have to sort of watch and see how often they hit a round that's like all turtles, but
yeah.
You can like type it out. There's only like X number of types of rounds given the combination of enemies and what you start with.
Okay.
And you can figure out like how those rounds loop internally, if that makes
sense. That makes sense.
So there he just like Stephen Boyer just used the move, and he swatted the B over to the left to turn the crab around, because otherwise if he wouldn't have gotten that hit on the B right and sent it at the right trajectory, that crab probably would have come down.
Yes, I've noticed that. I've noticed that a number of times. I've seen that technique
really
over and over, how you use it to flip the crab, to flip the what are they? They're called side steppers.
Side steppers. Okay, I just call them crabs.
I know. Well, that's. I was trying to use the appropriate terminology of shell, shell creepers, side steppers, fighter flies, and slip ice.
Slip. All right. Well. All right. We'll refer.
So
to
we'll incorporate that into our discussion. So looks like Stephen Boyer's hit 700,000 now, cranking along. This is round two. This is his second game. He still has an extra man. Stephen Kleisath is taking a little break after going for 1.1 million on his first game. So this is very, very, very exciting.
I agree with that in the chat. The NES had sprite limitations. That's why the icicles weren't included. I bet that's correct.
Oh, that makes sense.
I wish they were, because they're such a fun element, and they add a whole different positioning challenge to this game. I think it's much better looking and plays out better on the arcade.
Mason, where are you located?
I'm out in Pennsylvania, sort of outside Pittsburgh.
Oh, okay. All right. So you are the.
No, it starts the round.
Yes, Permafrost Rick, thank you for pointing that out. It's mostly, it's not me. I will definitely give Mason all the credit here. But Permafrost Rick said, love how you guys are catching some of the more subtleties that make a difference of getting 200,000 versus what these guys are scoring. Absolutely. I mean, if you're watching right now, Stephen Boyer's at almost 750,000. There are many subtleties. And he still has an extra man, so he's... He is ahead of pace for where Kleisath was on his first game. So Kleisath ended with 1.1 million, but he, for the longest time, I think from around half a million or more, was running on just a single man, which is very difficult. This should be a good game here for Stephen Boyer.
Thanks, man. I'll try to point out all the subtleties I notice.
Yeah, please do.
Thanks. Thank you for having me on, man. I love commentating video games.
Well, very cool.
That was good. That was Stephen Boyer had a nice jump there, and he knew exactly. It looks like he knew exactly to stick on the edge of that platform because a vertical jump at that point. Notice too how the purple crab comes down. He's on the POW block because that puts him with good mobility. He's on the middle platform, so the green fireball will generate a level
yes.
up. He's trying to control the generation of that green fireball by sort of luring it and making it appear where he wants it to be.
Yes, and it's smart doing it on the top level because he has more room to jump, whereas you have the restrictions of the levels above you. You have to time it perfectly, and any little misstep, if you're off, you could still be hit by the fireball.
Yeah. And it looks like now, as it goes on, because now there's two, and the stream kind of froze up for a minute, but the one fireball on the left is disappearing as another one on the right appears. And it doesn't look like it gets any more difficult than that, but I don't know, maybe it does, but it looks like there's sort of like two, so you sort of have to stagger.
Yeah, you know, I'm going to try something with Skype. Give me 1 minute. Stephen Boyer here is doing 800,000 now. Still has that extra man. Looks like Stephen Kleisath has his work cut out for him for number two.
Nice move.
All right, I'm back. Thanks for hanging with us. Looks like
that was a good move from Stephen Boyer. That I got those both those crabs grouped in the same way by doing that hit that propels them forward. There's a certain element of control that you have over the hit and which direction you send them. And you'll see that here almost immediately, I'm sure. There's the hit. Yep, and it turns the crab around. And then the group because you get a combo for it. That's a nice pattern. I see them using that quite
well, he always starts, I've noticed, always starts with you immediately get up, get the two shell creepers, but he pauses before he knocks that second shell creeper. There's like a good 3 second pause waiting for the timing because he knows that the sidestepper is going to pop out, I think, from the upper right. I'll watch again here on phase 90. So we're at phase 90, what I'm looking at. This one started a little different. He goes for the. This one started with two sidesteppers.
Yeah, different. I think you can. There would probably be a way to keep track of what's coming up first in the round.
Yes, I'm sure, definitely.
To pick that, because it looks like he's on round one, even though certain elements of the difficulty have maxed out, because it's sending him shell creepers. I think this turtles. Yes, but let's use.
Yeah, that's right. Shell creepers. That's right.
Yeah, shell creepers. All right, then we got the sidesteppers.
Yes,
it's got
this one has the side steppers. It started with side steppers and the slip ice that's coming out.
But he grouped those two immediately and then got under those icicles because he knows there's so much time before they fall. I don't see anyone trying to knock out icicles. Can you do that or do they kill you?
You can. If you jump when it's a drip, you can get it.
Yeah.
But otherwise, if it hits you, you're out. See, he just did that. Now, are you watching on Elite Lounge Live? I see. You're kind of bouncing between the two.
I just have the Elite Lounge stream page loaded up.
Got it. Okay, yeah. So it's going to be swapping between the two.
Yeah, Stephen Boyer's right now, I think. Because he's playing.
Yeah, so I may be a little ahead of you on what I'm seeing.
Oh, okay.
Because I'm watching... We have so many screens in here that I've got it patched all over various various levels. So, Merciless, we're doing very well. Thank you. How are you? How are you, Eric, it looks like?
Greetings. Doing well.
So, Stephen Boyer is doing great on his second game. He's at 864,000, and looks like Stephen Kleisath is ready to start his second game. We'll see if he can top his 1.102 from his first round game. I'm going to check one thing real quick. Be right back.
That was good for Stephen Boyer. Instead of taking the letting it flip around in the air, he just hit them so that they would group immediately. Looks like he wants these coins. And he'll get them. Didn't try to take out the slip ice, I'm assuming, because he knew the way the turtle would resolve, but I don't know. He knows that spot.
So let me check in here. What do we got? From what I'm seeing, Stephen Boyer is at 887,000. Still has his extra man. Looks like he's ahead of pace from where Stephen Kleisath was on his first game. So round one went to Stephen Kleisath with 1.1 million. 1,102,890. Stephen Boyer had 563,150. It was kind of a warm-up game for him. He's doing very well on this second game. And it looks like Stephen Kleisath is already straight into his second game. He has 20,000 points already, so we'll be checking in with that. Stinky Weasel Teats, the details are not exactly straightforward. This is a Mario off. So I am framing it this way: the winner of the rounds, as well as the winner of the evening, who best wins the evening, both by score and by number of rounds taken. We are going to midnight. Very exciting. We are also joined by Mason Kramer in Skype. There he is.
Hello.
Sweet long hair, sweet fuzzy sweater, and cool stuff on his gaming shelf in the background. Now, do you, Mason, do you hold any world records in any games?
Yes, I hold a whole bunch.
You hold a whole bunch. What is the world record that you are most proud of?
Oh, man. Okay, most proud of. There's a couple.
Okay.
Just the most recent one I got was the One Life Mario Brothers 3 points record on NES, and I beat Tom Vadova's record, who has the world record on this Mario Brothers.
That's right.
He had what, 4.9 million. I got 5.9 million and glitched out the game at the end of the sixth world, so I could do better than that. I got the max out 9,999,990 or 10 million on Super Mario World a couple years ago on One Life. I figured out some point pressing techniques in order to do that I don't think anyone had come up with before, but I don't know for sure, of course. Have a bunch of records on Atari. I beat Todd Rogers on Atari Centipede.
Really? Beat Todd Rogers? Wow.
Well, he set his score years ago, so I don't know. He could probably beat me if he wanted to, but he had, I think his posted record was like 1.5 million or something. I think I got 2.6 million or 2.9 million, and I had to save my neighbor from having a heart attack and stop the game, and that was a couple years ago.
You're like, but I'm going for the world record. Could you just hold off on having a heart attack? Jeez. I'll help you in like an hour, okay? I just need another solid hour. I'll get enough points. Just get your heart out of arrest and let me finish my game. Did you tell him? I mean, if you had said that, or just given like a couple chest hits and then...
I have the defibrillator plug in for my Atari, man. Just come here real quick. Right
just come here. Hold on. Coo-coo. All right, I'm back. meanwhile, while we're talking about this, we'll come back to you, Mason. Looks like Stephen Boyer is at 940. He's almost at 940,000 here, on his way to over a million. And he has one extra man still. Whereas Stephen Kleisath, in his first game, of course, did super well, 1,102,890 points, but he had to suffer through just grinding through on no extra men. It looks like Merciless 365 is saying, who I believe is Eric. I don't know Eric's last name, but he's saying that your Super Mario World record was very special.
Is that... Merciless, are you... You're not fellow Root, are you? Because if you are, what's up, dude? I missed you. If anyone was around a couple years ago when I did the Mario World Max Out, it was... We debated the rules a lot, and in the end, we sort of came to an agreement about things that would have been leeching in the game, and eventually I wound up... coming up with a point pressing technique that generates infinite combos from shells. Uh-oh. Or locks the shelf. Oh, hey, Eric. It's nice to see you, man. There's a lot of Erics.
It is. Oh, hang on one sec. In 102,890. Stephen Boyer seems like he just had kind of a nice little warm-up game with 563,000. Just really got back into the swing of things, and now is really showing his strategy and skill here. That is really smart with bopping the side stepper once, slipping over to the fighter fly, knocking the fighter fly over enough that he causes, like you had mentioned before, he causes the flip in the sidestepper and then is able to knock out both. It's great strategy.
And assuming you could always do that, assuming that you get that combination from the two pipes that, like, they're the generator, he can always get that move.
Right on the edge,
every single time, and gets it right before. That's a really, you really got to put some practice into the timing of that. I mean, those sort of like half pattern moves are just automatic.
Right. The timing too is very difficult on the for me. Let's see, is he gonna? Oh, is it? He's at 995,000. He's gonna pass a million here on this one. Yeah, so he gets the shell creepers there. This time he didn't pause for the fighter fly. Interesting. It's because it's a different level, because the sidestepper is not on this one. Boy, that's a lot to keep track of. In your experience in marathoning and playing games all the way through, you really have to know the level pattern and know what comes up next. Was that fair to say?
Yeah, or at some point. Knowing is one thing, being able to do is another thing. So any patternable game is going to be subject to a sort of decay, and you're going to have to be able to improvise. Even something like Pac-Man, where it's like patterns, you still need to know how to improvise, because human error can get enough 16th of a second worth of timing difference, and now he's going to have to compensate somehow. So while it can't be patterned, you have to watch out, and you have to be able to play freehand, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, so if you're just joining us, let me catch you up, because Archerman is asking, in Skype at the moment, you've got, we have Mason Kramer, who is a.k.a. the Mario Magician, who has a number of world records, is helping add some insight and commentary here to our Mario Off. We have two amazing players, Stephen Boyer, who is third in the world, and Stephen Kleisath, who is fifth in the world in Mario Bros. That is what we are watching right now. You are seeing game number two for both of them. In round number one, Stephen Boyer scored 563,000 points, and Stephen Kleisath had 1,102,000 points. And so Kleisath taking round one. Round two now going very strong for Stephen Boyer. He has an extra man, and he is at 1,013,000, doing very well, which is ahead of where Stephen Kleisath was at this moment of points in the game. Really had a tricky spot there. Had to avoid fireballs, wanting to get that purple sidestepper who had flipped. Archer Man, I just told you who's Lounge Live 1. That is Mason Kramer. Then Wolfman. Wolf, can I sometimes call you Wolfman? Because I just did.
Sure.
Thank you. But back to Wolf's Den. Make sure, Archer Man, and anyone else watching, that you're on our team page, EliteLoungeLive.com, so you can click around and see. We are auto-switching the main feed back and forth between these games, but you should be able to... you should be able to see as well. So when you, what's the largest crowd that you've been by when you set a record, Mason?
Me?
Yeah.
You know, I would love, when I did the Mario Brothers 3 world record, which was like the latest world record that I broke, I did it on my live stream. We played the Dave Vogt's game, The Bounty. I was one of the players.
Yeah, so you played The Bounty. So you've been into Elite Lounge Live before, correct?
Yeah. We played The Bounty on it a little while ago. I came in second, I believe.
Okay, very cool.
Fun game, good stuff. You know, and here's the thing about, like, you know, the stuff I do, I understand that classic console gaming is a niche kind of thing. I understand that. So I would love to play to tons and tons of people. I think I do better when there's, you know, when I'm like, I like to be a performer. I play guitar and I play music and I like to perform, you know, and I see these games as like performance art. So I would love to perform for tons and tons of people, but the most I think I've ever had, just the amount of interest that I can garner, 20 or 30 people were on my stream when I broke the Mario 3 record. Not that many, but, you know, I grew up playing in, you know, crummy bands, and if there were two people in the audience, we'd play our guts out for those two people, so...
Right.
It's, you know, I would love to play for the masses and perform and do this thing, and, you know, so far I haven't got that chance yet, but who knows, you know?
What you're saying is you would like to be... in the movie The Wizard, with the power glove on, fighting against Fred Savage. Have you seen?
You know, Lucas, that kid's he's not as tough as he seems. He put on the power glove and beat the first level of Rad Racer. I think there are four or five or six other levels.
Yeah, exactly.
He beat one level of Rad Racer. And
I know. We would do the real life version of the Wizard. Let's somehow make that happen. Let's bring back the Nintendo World Championship.
I would love to. I'm part of the NES Club film that's coming out, and we're, you know, talking to NES players and stuff. I would for a little while at the same time.
Really?
I could try. It would take some practice, but I could try.
Okay, I think you should work on that, because if you could beat. You could beat Jace Hall playing Kaboom while juggling, it would be the greatest thing in the world.
I don't.
Gender.
Yes.
Is he playing on a
cabinet? I can only juggle juggle balls or bags.
That's a good question.
I can only do two in one hand, but I can do like devil sticks where you just got the one, like you have the baton and the two guide sticks and you spin them around. I like those. And I want to get the like the ones you can, they have like wicks at the end, you can light them on fire.
Oh, yeah. Well, fire and electronics usually don't go together, but we could figure out some kind of daredevil stunt. This is a good question. Jennifer Zhang is joining us in the lounge here, in a beautiful dress today.
It's me. I'm here. Again.
You did it. The go ahead, ask your question, because
so I'm wondering, are our two competitors today playing on entirely different systems?
So this is Stephen. You're watching Stephen Boyer in the straightforward shot. So that's Stephen Boyer.
So that's Boyer, and the other one is.
It looks like Boyer's playing MAME.
Is that like on a computer, or is that on a cabinet that he's?
Yeah, it's MAME is a computer. It stands for Multiple Arcade Machine Emulator.
Well, yes, we're aware of. It's because that's what we use on our beautiful cabinet here. That's okay. Don't worry. No offense.
No.
He thought we were dumb.
He thinks we're stupid.
He thinks
Tanner.
We're so dumb.
He thinks we know anything about video games.
We don't even know what MAME is.
We're frauds. Please don't tell James.
Listen,
don't tell him.
Don't tell James.
Okay?
Don't tell anyone. No.
Xander.
Yes.
I think one of the computers fell asleep.
Yeah, I fixed it already. Thank you, sir.
All right.
Yes. No, so the question is, oh, wait, hold on. We have to point out that Stephen Boyer has just surpassed Stephen Kleisath's first round top score. He is at 1,124,000, and he still has his extra man. He is killing it. And jumping back over to see Stephen Kleisath on his first he still has three men with 264,000 on his second game. So back to the question that Jennifer was asking. The question is
playing on a stand-up cabinet.
Yes.
While Boyer is playing on like a computer emulator with like computer keys or something. Does anyone know? See the top of that computer window.
Yeah, it definitely says that is a MAME. It is the MAME that he could have full screened it, which then it wouldn't say that, but that just helps show what he's playing on. But what we're looking at in Stephen Kleisath's window, you know, it's very angled and it's a CRT. So, is it an arcade or is it an emulator on an arcade-like machine? Do we know? Does anyone in the chat know?
I don't know for sure. That was a cool clear for Stephen Boyer, though, getting right up in front of that green fireball.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, he's
playing. Could knock them out in the air. That was very good.
So strong I sound in Kleisath. Yeah. So it's pronounced. It reminds me of Flysath.
Oh, I'm sorry. Flysath.
Kleisath.
Rogueless, thank you for now correcting me, since I have been saying it wrong for an entire hour. So Rogueless.
We're frauds.
I appreciate it.
We don't know anything.
And for shame on all of you who knew that and didn't correct me, I would.
You just let him go on like that for an hour.
Yes. So Kleisath is doing very well. Thank you very much. Drunk Guy 89 says it is an arcade. Okay. Kleisath is a real machine. Okay, so gotcha. We've got MAME versus real machine.
Aha. Interesting indeed.
Real machine.
No, he just means an actual arcade cabinet. He's not saying like the real deal.
I do enjoy Kleisath's Steve Kleisath's. It's fun to say. Artistic angle choice here.
Yes, it does.
A little off kilter.
Yeah.
It makes
it's very difficult to get a CRT to pick up with a video camera. Or it can be, at least.
Yes, because of the refresh rate and the fact that it's that it's interlaced and will normally. Yeah. So, well done.
Form follows function, I guess.
There we go. Jumping right into where Stephen Boyer is. He is at 1,164,260. Still has that extra man. He's doing very well. And then jumping back to Stephen Kleisath, who is, because clearly I've said Kleisath the entire time. Kleisath is doing very well. Still has three men on his second game with 304,000. Definitely wants to outdo his first round. Kleisath had 1.1. He had 1,102,890, whereas Stephen Boyer had 563. He has utterly destroyed that, Boyer has, with 1,173,000 that he's at right now.
Yeah, you are a little bit in front of me. I'm showing 161 on my screen.
Well, I didn't want to tell you this, but the power of Leet Lounge Live allows us to go into the future, see the score. Right now, it's only like a few minutes. We don't want to max out the power of the ultimate game machine.
Well, you also don't want to go too far into the future because you can affect
the space-time continuum. Absolutely.
Yeah, sound of thunder, man. You step on a butterfly, wrong guy's going to win the election.
Exactly. Don't want the butterfly effect.
Yeah.
Backward, but it would be reverse butterfly effect.
The reverse butterfly effect.
But that wouldn't make sense. If you destroyed something in the future, it wouldn't affect the past.
He is the Kleisath Chatterack.
Rogless, you would never sound like a jerk saying, "Hey, dummy, say his name Kleisath." Kleisath. See, I just said it wrong. Now just call me a dummy. That's fine.
I don't even imagine.
Kleisath sounds like a planet in the Dagobah system.
It does.
Kleisath.
Yeah. Going to the or like a star system in and of itself. Like
so it'd be.
We must change course to Kleisath.
Doesn't it?
Yeah. As we joke, Stephen Boyer has hit the 1,203,010 mark. Holy shnikes. Traveling back now into the present time, you could probably see him at 1,189,000.
So they've each already, I see what you're doing, so they've already reached a million, it's reset. And
yes.
So you're adding a million to that.
Yes, now not here. Now this is Stephen Kleisath's, and he's at 325,000 on his, did you?
No, he hasn't, he's 200,000, he hasn't died yet.
Oh.
He's at 1.2. Where is he gonna, I'm waiting for it now.
I know, it's a suspense.
Let's see, he's got, it's loading again. That's cool.
Oh, we switched away from it for you, but you're gonna see it in the right hand side in one of these.
Yeah,
side.
I loaded it back up. I missed it.
Totally missed it. All right. Well, just telling you the future of where he's going. He's at 1,224,000 right now, doing very well. This on his last man, and looks like Stephen Kleisath is at 357,000, doing very well, still with three men in his pocket.
And another one, never mind. what strange climate does this game take place in where icicles, crabs, and turtles can coexist?
That is very interesting. And that fire can be both normal color and green and blue.
Interesting.
So clearly one is propane.
Yes.
Or some kind of natural gas.
Uh-huh.
Know what you're going to find in the sewers.
That's true. Don't light a match.
It's like...
Oh, Charlie! And light a match! Remember that?
No, I mean, why you get down in the sewers? You can find all kinds of great things. We found jeans the other day.
The light a match was from... So I Married an Axe Murderer. Have you seen that?
Mm-mm.
Oh. Classic.
Way too hard.
Oh, there we go. Lost his first man, Kleisath did. And is at 364,000. Doing very well. In the meantime, Stephen Boyer on game number two is doing very well. He's at 1,258,410 on his last man. Killing it.
I saw Kleisath's last death. He was really fighting his way out of that. He could have made that too. He looks like he screwed up that jump and he didn't want to go down between those platforms. He wanted to cross them on the top. But it looks like he just
It's important to know that it looks like you really have to be careful of the timing on the icicles. Once they've gone full icicle from the drip, it looks like you have a good 3 seconds.
Yeah, at least 3 or 4.
Right.
I don't know. Now the question is, because I don't know this for sure, are they dangerous when they are full icicle but not falling?
Yes, from what I've seen, you cannot jump into them. You have to avoid them.
Right, but you can still get them while they're in the drip, just once they go full icicle.
Once they're full icicle, stay away. He's hanging tough in Phase 98, which we learned, for those of you who are new to Mario Brothers. Phase 98 stays, that's where it doesn't roll over, and he's at 268,900. Dan Man, if you are asking if the lovely Jennifer Zhang is Mrs. X, she is not. Carrie Denke is my wife, but Jennifer Zhang is also amazing, and she is one of the hosts here. As I mentioned earlier, there's Jennifer Zander, which is me. There's Adam Rady, and there's also Matt Hiscox. Matt is out for the day, but Adam Rady is over working on an edit.
Dan Man might have been asking you if you're Mrs. Zan, just to be a jerk.
Oh, that's true.
He might be saying that you
that
are
I'm
calling a girl.
That
you a girl.
I'm Professor X's wife.
Or so, yeah.
What a jerk.
Yep. Dan Man, that is out of line.
Out of line.
Xander is here.
Out of line.
Diligently following this Mario off. And you insult his masculinity?
Last time I checked, yes, I am still a boy. looks like.
How often do you check?
What?
How often do you feel like, whew, for a second there?
Every 3 days, it's important to check, just for health reasons. Stephen Boyer here is rapidly approaching 2 million. He's at, no wait, I'm way off. He's rapidly approaching, yeah, don't listen to me, Mr. Kleisath. See, even Mr. Kleisath did not correct me, but now I'm saying it correctly because I was corrected in
he's
the last
Japanese point. In
but,
that way.
But he's rapidly approaching 1.3 million, thank you very much. I just got a little excited.
No, you just saw into the future.
I did see into the future.
Oh, you're not wrong. He is approaching 2 million.
That is true. He just has 750,000 more points to go.
Yeah.
Some get Jen before she gets married. I'm never getting married. And that's the thing that I say that my parents hate the most.
Maybe they hate that?
They get real mad. My dad's like, that's because you're stupid. No, he's not saying I'm stupid and that's why I will never get married. He's saying because I never want to get married because I'm being stupid.
Got it. Well, and Dan Man was one-upping me on my quotes from So I Married an Axe Murderer, Are You Mrs. X? Yeah, it was very good. Well done. I haven't seen the movie in a while. It's great. It's some of Mike Myers' best before he got a little too Mike Myers.
Before Austin Powers?
It was way before Austin Powers. It's very good.
Austin Powers.
You should watch it. It's funny. Woman, woman.
What was Dr. Evil?
He does spoken word, like beat poetry.
Uh-huh.
He comes up and he like lights a cigarette, takes a puff, hits it, and then it's like, woman. What up, man? Are you a... I can't even remember. It's just very funny. Yeah.
Even if
untrusting, unknowing, unlove, Ed. Woman.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, it's a great movie.
Even if someone gets Jen, she will always escape. It's true. I'm wily. I'm slippery.
Oh, yeah.
Like, that.
like a ninja.
Like a ninja or like some kind of... wet snake.
Isn't a snake by itself? Why does it have to be wet?
Because they're harder to hold on to. I should have said?
A wet willy.
Like
a water
wet
willy.
Willy.
A water willy. No, no, a water willy.
Oh, yeah. Oh, they're called water willies.
Yeah, that goes foom.
Oh, yeah. You sell them at Natural Wonders.
In the interim, while we were discussing wet willies and water willies and wet snakes, Stephen Boyer.
Austin Powers.
Yeah.
Oh, go cry yourself to sleep on your huge pillow.
Aww.
Stephen Boyer is still going strong. Keep it up, Stephen. He's got 1,355,160, beating out Stephen Kleisath's first round high score of 1,102,890.
Looks like that last group he did to clear that previous board was a freehand one, too. That was a nice group combo.
Very nice group combo. I would agree with that.
Shadow Clone has proposed to me. Shadow Clone, I'm going to say a tentative yes, but I'm leaving you an out because I'm going to give you a few of the circumstances with which you are going to be dealing with. One, I have night terrors, but not like I'm terrified at night, more like I'm a terror at night. I will beat you up and have no recollection of it the next morning when you are in a coma. But in bed, I can last a very impressive 45 seconds before I get sleepy. I promise you, though, those 45 seconds are going to be the most disappointing of your life. So, I'm sleepy.
I'm sleepy.
I do a lot. I'm sleepy all
the
time.
Are you done? I'm sleepy.
I'm more sleepy.
I guarantee you, you have not experienced disappointment on the level at which I can deliver. Let's see, what else? What else do I do? I think
he's still sold. Shadow Clone is actually
okay?
Yeah, is nerdgasming as we speak.
Just a few things. I prefer that you wear a full-on Ninja Turtle costume to bed. A child pinches off circulation in certain parts, but it's just one of my requirements. Otherwise, I can't go to sleep, which is important to me because I need to go to sleep and then become a terror and terrifies you.
Right. So that just protects Shadow.
The shell is
Shadow from.
Yes,
from
a
the terror
bit of, the cushion.
Of the night.
Yes, terror of the night. I will call you Darkwing Duck during, even though you are wearing a Ninja Turtle costume. But it's okay, because you only have to suffer that indignation for 45 seconds.
At least you're not calling him Howard the Duck.
Dan Man says you sound perfect.
Nothing disappoints me, Shadow Clone. It's like, nothing disappoints me.
You might be,
perfect man.
I might be future Mrs. Shadow Clone.
I would really hope that his actual name is Shadow Clone, so you could be Mrs. Shadow Clone.
No deal unless the 1000 is actually a part of it as well, right. Because I do want to be pulled over by a cop and he's looking at my license and is like, well, Mrs. Jennifer Shadow Clone 1000. Do you know why you've been pulled over today?
I bet you could change your name, too.
To Shadow Clone 1000? Oh, man.
Dan Man said, I'll ninja wrap you to sleep. Go, ninja. Dang. Go, ninja. Go. Go, ninja. Go, ninja.
Shadow Clone is facing some stiff competition from Dan Man.
Let's check in with our players here.
Yes.
Stephen Kleisath has handily passed the 500,000 mark, 500,000 points, still having two extra mans, and we have a real whopper of a game here going with Stephen Boyer. He's at 1,402,480. He has this is his last man, and he is really taking great advantage of it. Very impressed here.
And Lightning Shiny Butt, hopefully that answers a question that you didn't know you had. Not only are we playing Mario, not us, we're just sitting here like pansies while these fine fellas here, Stephen Kleisath, I did it,
he
and
did it.
Stephen Boyer, do all the heavy lifting. And they're both champion Mario Brothers players, and they're demonstrating some of their gaming prowess.
Interesting fact here, Jennifer. Stephen Boyer is third in the world, and Stephen Kleisath is fifth. So this is very exciting that Stephen Kleisath took round one with 1,102,890, and Stephen Boyer kind of had a warm-up round of 563,000. But in this second round, he is destroying it right now, currently on his last man at 1,417,170.
So I know what I'm doing.
Just a little heads up, right by in the upper left-hand corner by the pipe, there are two men there, and he has no men. Yes, so he is on his last man here, doing very well. We also are joined in Skype in Lounge Live 1 by Mason Kramer, who has a number of world records himself. He is a Mario aficionado, a.k.a. I'm not exactly sure. I really need to look into... I looked at our upstream. Our upstream is fine. I looked at our broadcast. It's fine on that end. It's somehow, it's possibly the in between. I don't believe that it is Twitch. I believe that it's us. But I don't believe it's an internet problem. It's the communication between the two. But Shadow Clone, I wanted to mention real quick, Eric Bauza was here, and he is Tiger Claw in that crossover. It's an hour-long episode from the new Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Very cool, and they have a crossover with all the originals. Cam Clark, who has been here, who was Leonardo.
Oh, yeah.
And was hilarious.
Oh, we have to have Cam Clark back now
that
we're on
Twitch.
Yeah,
we need to have him back. Yeah. Because, and we'll have them out again. 100%. We could not stop laughing.
No, he was amazing.
He was hilarious. Shadow Clone says Twitch in general has been crappy lately. Interesting. But rapidly approaching 1.5 million is Stephen Boyer tearing it up. We're constantly switching between cameras, but if you're on LeetLoungeLive.com, which is our Twitch team page, it's just a URL to get you there quicker. Go to LeetLoungeLive.com and you can switch around on the cameras so you can swap back and forth as we're already auto doing. I'm going to say take it away, Jennifer, for some amazingness here. What are you doing?
I can't stop messing with it.
Stop.
No.
What would help you to not touch it?
To not have it on my face. I don't like it. It's like having a sticker on my face. It's
now, did you apply those? Did you apply the new
These
tape?
I did.
Okay. Well done.
I'm not terribly happy.
Yeah, Dan Man is absolutely right. A rapidly approaching 1.5 million. Is that what I said, or did I say 5 million?
1.5.
You said 1.5.
Oh, thank you.
Kinagami,
that was
here.
A nice clear for Stephen Boyer at the beginning of that wave. They're getting the bounce right off the edge of that. That's really, really hard to do, and he runs the risk of dying by jumping up into it and touching it. It's a really, really touchy move. That was a nice kill, too, on that that sidestepper there, getting it with the icicle falling in half the sprite image. That was cool. A lot of stuff. He's playing like a man on fire right now. I'm really enjoying to watch this. He's really good at predicting the flow. You also notice, too, as soon as he hits the last one, when he's on the last enemy, the last one on the screen automatically gets mad. He knows that ahead of time, and he compensates for it. I saw him do a clear a couple boards ago where he killed something, ran immediately to the bottom right, and compensated for the fact that he knew where that
yes.
purple was.
Well, it's just like, I'm not sure if you already saw it, but he hits two of the shell creepers. If you already saw the two shell creepers, and then he paused, immediately went into it, hopped up to the top tier, and knew that hell was going to come because two fireballs were unleashed. A sidestepper popped out, and he knew right then to get in there.
Mm-hmm. It looks like he's playing with, and this is just my guess, but it looks like he's playing with the timing of the fireball generation, that he knows how long, he knows the delay between when the level starts and when that first fireball is going to generate, and if he were to move too soon, he would be off position and generate it where he didn't want it to be. Because remember, it generates on the level that you're on. Or at least there's a moment every X number.
Oh, no. Well, I mean, I'm not telling you anything.
No. What is this oh no?
Oh, wow. Well, wait till you see the oh no.
All right. Well, I'll try not to miss this one and figure out what happened. I've noticed either both players don't like to use the screen wraparound very much. Oh,
right.
That was ugly. Looks like he thought it would go right over his head. He was just a little
he
bit
He did.
Too
I know. He should. If he had just scooted away from the edge,
he's
might.
A little bit, but it seems like with the economy of movement that you have to sort of add to this game, that like
So you know, what?
They don't waste movements. You see them. They don't waste jumps. They don't waste movements. Everything is like the move to make at that particular time. Looks like he thought it would just cut right over his head, and probably due to the angle that the fireballs make, if he had been a little bit more to the left, it would have sort of cut through his image, but it wouldn't have got his hitbox. At least that's the way it seems to me.
Yes. 495, 110. So there it is. Stephen Boyer, second game, round two. Nice job. 1,495,110. He outscores Kleisath from the first round. Hey, who's that in Lounge Live 2?
That is Lightning.
Hey, Lightning Butt.
Hey, there he is. Lightning. Lightning Butt.
Lightning Shiny Butt.
Lightning Butt. But there it was, 495, 110. Congrats, Stephen Boyer, on a tremendous second round, 1,495,110. Jumping over to Stephen Kleisath on his second game in round
two,
his game of round two, he is at 632,000 already. He still has an extra man, so hopefully he will continue to go on.
Xander's forgotten that he has to pee. I can tell. If you had a...
Jennifer and I, or probably mostly me, I think even Jen will probably take a break here in a second as well. We're going to take over for Xander for just a little bit because we are not awesome Mario players that can go for hours at a time. Xander has to pee. So let's just face facts. So if you have never met me before, my name is Adam Rady. I'm one of the hosts here, as well as Jennifer Zhang. And you guys have been chatting with Xander Denke for a majority of the evening so far. So thanks for tuning in. I know we're having some stream trouble, and that's not the peeing kind. That's the kind of internet stream. We've been having some issues where we keep dropping in and out. So hopefully you're hearing my overly loud voice.
Awesome job.
I can hear you.
My friend.
We've got one Stephen congratulating the other. I believe that's Stephen Kleisath. Kleisath. Congratulating Stephen Boyer on his 1.4 million score. Pretty redonkulous. I can't do much of anything for more than like an hour and a half. So the fact that these guys are going for any length of time, that's kind of pretty awesome. So sorry, Shadow Clone 1000, the stream is down for you. You may not be able to hear my voice at this point. That's Mason up there in Lounge Live 1, correct?
Oh, yes.
Hey, Mason. Mason. Pleasure to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well, Hissa.
And then we've got Wolf's Den down there in Lounge Live 6. And then that's Shiny Butt in Lounge Live 2, isn't it? Yeah, that's Shiny Butt. Yeah, that's a great, that's Lightning Shiny Butt, Jen. One of our new favorite names here in the lounge.
Pretty awesome.
Jen adds, pretty awesome. So Skypers, I tried to add in the both cameras for both players in there for you. I don't know if that will. You probably still can't read their scores, but at least you could probably see their gameplay a little bit within Skype.
I can see it. I can see Steven Boyer's a little better if it's the angle, but
yeah, it looks good.
Man, they are throwing some crazy shit.
Wow. This is pretty wild. So it's kind of cool here in the lounge. I don't know if you guys can tell or not, but we've got multiple TVs, of course, but we've got two awesome TVs up here that we've got each of them live on, or as live as we can get them, and we're watching their streams here. So that's why you see me looking up in the air. It's not because I don't want to look at all of your wonderful names or faces. Just trying to watch. But it's hilarious because one's on one side of the room and the other's on the other, so I keep turning from one to the other.
Steve Kleisath and Steve Boyer both run the same bonus level pattern.
Now, is that because that is the way to do that bonus level, or is that just because they both happen to adapt the same way?
I would say it's probably one of the most effective ways, given that you don't have much of a margin of error per moves. I run a different bonus level pattern on the NES version, but I'm not sure if it would work here, and it is kind of touchy. I'm sure it's not the only way to do it, but it's probably a very consistent, very solid, re-executable one.
Well, now, so So Mason, you could probably answer this question for me, and if there's anybody else in the chat that that has some insight into this, whether you're just part of the classic gaming community or whether you yourself are amazing high scorers like Mason and the two Stevens here, pretty incredible. How do you, because I'm sure this question gets asked a million different times in a million different ways, but how do you practice a game like this? Is it learning the patterns? Is it adapting the hand-eye coordination? What's the best way? Is it, I mean, practice makes perfect, obviously, but are you just trying to memorize the patterns? Or are you, well, how do you go about it?
That's such a wonderful question, dude. Where to begin? I can feel this one. You know, I play games and I have world records and stuff. It's part of it is learning the meta rules of the game, learning, you know, practicing, okay, you know, these guys are going to come on this level and this is going to happen, you know, all the secrets of the game. The other part is like working on like controller fundamentals. You know what I mean? A quick flick left and right, a pixel perfect jump. And it's like so much about what you're doing with your hands involved with the game and not even understanding the meta rules of it, but just understanding how to play games in general. It's a Zen kind of thing. You know, like in Enter the Dragon, when like Bruce Lee's learned all this martial arts and his master comes and says, what is the goal with your style? And Bruce Lee says, to have no style. That kind of martial arts adaptability sort of thing. There's like all these basic moves you can have for any game, and then it's about tweaking them and applying them and understanding like the Zen of it. I know that's kind of a vague answer.
No, that's not a vague answer at all, and I don't want to take away from that answer because I want to come back to it here in a second, but I want to point out that Steven, and I'm going to keep butchering his last name and I don't mean to, Kleisath, correct? Unfortunately, he ran into an issue while you were answering the question. He got attacked by, those are little crabs, right? Lobsters? What are those?
Sidesteppers.
Yeah. Sidesteppers. He got hit. He knocked one down, and it got up, like, immediately and hit him. He gave a strong reaction to not being very pleased about that. So I guess that...
The thing about it is, all games are the same at a core sort of level. That you, when you learn one game and you learn style, you can apply that to any game that you can find those same things with. You know, certain Atari games where you have to do one basic thing like move around could be thought of like a kata for particular moves. Kool-Aid Man is a good kata for controller articulation and that sort of thing. So, like, when you pick up a game at first, like, what I always do is immediately peg the movement. There's a little thing you can do with your mind where whatever object I'm moving in the game, whatever character I am, I can feel that as a physical object. So say it's like a platform type game. The very first thing to do is feel the gravity, feel the jump articulation, which translates into how long do I hold the button down to achieve maximum jump height? What's the trajectory? How, you know, how many positions of speed can I get? You know what I mean? Things like that. And you can start, like, feeling it. If you treat it like a physical thing, for me, it, like, corresponds better. It's like I'm using the controller to move a physical object that has a particular weight, gravity, momentum, friction, all of that.
I find that funny because I do the exact same thing.
Yeah. Cool, man.
So, yeah, it's... So real quick, sorry Mason, and sorry Shiny, but again, it's kind of funny because every time you're giving us these awesome answers, something is happening in the game. So we want to just call out real quick to Steven, who just finished his second game. Unfortunately, he got hit with an icicle in a really sort of odd, his comment was, I don't think I've ever seen that before. And I think I heard him say he's going to give Steven Boyer a call real quick. And maybe they'll discuss going into their... Because I think it'll be the third game for each of them.
I think we should both start one more. And then just
I think it is the third game.
One more try. I just got in.
So I can hear them discussing a little bit, but they're a little bit off camera, so I can't quite tell what they're saying. But it does sound like they're going to go for another game, each of them.
I could give you an example of what I was talking about based on Mario Brothers that we're watching. If you notice, there's certain... Based on your speed and when you press the jump button, you can get
so many different trajectories of jump, and you have like X amount of momentum plus X height of jump equals like only so many different trajectories. And if
right.
you have them all memorized and pegged, you can pull out which one you want at any given time because you know how it feels to get to move the controls that way.
Right.
So I sometimes when I try to explain this stuff, I feel like I don't like make sense at all.
Well, no, it's very, it's actually really cool because Jace Hall, who's obviously the owner of HD Films and thus Elite Lounge Live, and he's the guy that created this cool space that we do our thing at, where the Elite Lounge is, in fact, that's Jace's office right there. But Jace very much believes in gamer fundamentals, and his favorite demonstration of that is to play the Atari and play Kaboom on the Atari. And show, he's like, it's just left and right. That's all you have to do. He's like,
well,
so
it's left and right, but there's technicalities involved with it.
Of course, of course.
There's drag, there's positioning, there's hit detection, there's all kind. I love Kaboom, man.
Oh, yeah, but his love for that game is that when he gets gamers that say, well, I can beat you in Call of Duty, or I can beat you in this, or I can beat you in that, his joke is, well, if you can't move left and right, then how are you going to do all those things? So it's very fun to watch Jace react.
Yeah.
And what are we doing? We didn't mean to be talking over you. We are listening and ready for what is coming next. So we'll wait to hear what Steve has to say because we're on a delay. It's like talking to the surface of the moon.
Well, hey guys, everybody that can hear me on my personal Twitch page, this is going to be my last try tonight. Me and Stephen Boyer, we're both going to go for our last try. Figure we'll consider this the tiebreaker round, because I won the first round, he won the second. We both got our goal tonight, which was getting over 1 million points. That's what we wanted to do on the spot in the live setting. And we were both able to accomplish that, so we're both pretty happy about it. So this is like the rubber match, this third round. I see the 1337 is offline at the moment, so they're in a heavy delay to even be right now. So anybody that can hear me, I know I've eight people.
We'll be right back as well.
My personal feed. Me and Stephen Boyer are going to start the last try.
I'm building a creeper.
Or hopefully we will, but Stephen can hear me. And then we're just going to play until the end on our third game. And the third round will determine who wins this first installment of the Mario Off. Thank you all so much for watching us and 1337 Lounge for having us. It's greatly appreciated. We really wanted to give acknowledgement to one of the greatest classic arcade games ever made. We feel it should be right up there with the ranks of Donkey Kong as one of the greats. And hopefully this will be a resurgence in interest and spark energy for people to pick up this game. Because if it wasn't for this game, you wouldn't have Super Mario Bros. You see the world from now.
I hope everybody was able to hear that, and I hope you can hear me now because I know the stream is down. But Steven's just informed us they're going to go for one more try. They're going to consider it the rubber match, their third go at it this evening. They are they're pretty pleased with what happened tonight because they both in the live setting were able to get over 1 million points. So they're going to go for it one more time. We are experiencing technical difficulties. Wolf, if you can continue to type thing him.
Wow.
Just wanted you guys to know the Stevens both are going to go for one more try each. They're very happy that they both in the live setting where you get over 1 million points. They're going to go for their third round here, the tiebreaker match, as it were. Sorry for our stream having these technical difficulties dropping in and dropping out. We're doing the best we can to try to accommodate this, but we're just happy everybody's here checking out these two world-class players and keep tuning in.
Are you ready?
So thanks a lot, guys. I think they're going to go for it again. Again, massive delay here, so if I'm talking over anybody, I apologize for that.
Okay, let me get to my game. Good luck, sir, on the rubber match, and
I'm also pushing the links to both of their streams at the same time.
Thanks a lot, Wolf.
And
Yeah.
Just in case if the lounge is still keeping going and down and stuff, they can go and watch both streams.
Thanks for watching. I appreciate it as always. And, and we would love to do some Mario Ops in the future with other players that we know who are also very good.
Not that anyone was wondering, but I'm drinking Goose Island 10 Hills Pale. Quality.
That's awesome. We'd love to get, I'm building a creeper.
Goose Island, all right. Different,
you know, quadrants, it looks like, to show different games or different people playing. We'd love to get the Mario off, too.
I don't even know what that is, to be honest.
That's a brewery from Chicago. They do good IPAs.
Steven probably already started if they keep it. So I'm about to start my last try. I'm pretty tired. I know Steven is too. But we both got our goals and we're happy about that. And now we'll go through this last game and see how far we can get. Talk to you guys once again. Thanks for watching. Keep on keeping on. And we'll talk to you guys later. And away we go.
So, again, we're suffering from a massive delay, so I certainly don't want to be talking over anybody, which is why I've been pretty silent here. But I wanted to thank both both Steven and Steven for letting us restream their streams. Been very pleased with the results. Here at Elite Lounge Live, you have the ability to switch camera angles as long as you're on our website. Unfortunately, our website is being pretty laggy today. So, understandable if you are not watching us from there today. But please keep tuning in to watch these guys as they finish up their last match. Going for it one more time. They've informed us that they are pretty tired, but they're pretty happy with the results of today, and they're going to try to get this thing one more go and see who the winner is in their tiebreaker match here.
Looks like Kleisath yesterday.
But Clegg had gotten that before or something close. But we had to reset the scores because we had to replace MAME with an updated version of MAME. Yeah, the Cat Despera has actually pointed out that the strategies these guys use are very impressive. And I know, Mason, you were talking about the patterns that they follow and how each of them will follow the similar bonus stage pattern, correct? I'm using the correct
analogy. They have the same bonus stage pattern, and they have a few pseudo patterns that seem to work for the enemy waves. But most of those patterns kind of get derailed, and it looks to be by the icicles. They seem to know what enemies are coming up first and how to manipulate them. I mean, they have really good flow control, both of them. The bonus level pattern is the same because it's sort of an objective thing. But they sort of have to, like, the opening of any enemy's wave is a bit patterned, and then the rest of it seems to be freehand, and the icicles determine horizontal, vertical position and can throw patterns off. So they have to be ready to improvise on the fly.
Well, I've noticed a strategy that where they are able to group all of them on that center platform. I've never even, I've played Mario Brothers before, but I have no idea what I'm doing besides, like, oh, I jump up and hit that, and you know. So
well,
to see that kind of strategy.
Groups of enemies are in combos when you hit them like less than X seconds apart, and it looks like they do that for the turtles wave. Because it can generate a large combo, and ideally, because you only have to kill so many enemies to end the wave, ideally what they'd want to do is end every wave with a double combo, it looks like, to prevent the last enemy from getting mad. But yeah, normally they want to at least, you see them produce two enemy combos a lot. It looks like Kleisath is trying to get those two turtles up there and maybe even funnel some of the sidesteppers into it. Yeah, and then he uses the pal. Now Kleisath has got this whole line here, and he clears it all. That was a really good move, and it looks like that was more freehand-ish. He might have patterned that a bit, or at least knew it was coming. He deliberately doesn't kill the last turtle, so he can spam the points from the coins and now kills the turtle to end the round. That was a good round. That was a good example of pattern ability. It looks like until you get into the later stages where the icicles are falling, it looks like most of this is pretty routine play for them, as it should be, of course. The early stages, you know, for any serious competitor should be pretty routine because they know what's coming, and these stages serve to introduce the enemy types and give you a chance to mess with them a little bit. So it looks like this is pretty routine for both of them.
Yeah, I would not that I'll pretend to know that much, but yeah, I would totally recognize and agree with what you're saying there, that the earlier stages seem to be I wouldn't say easy for them, because I'm sure nothing's easy. Like you said, anything could go wrong at any point, but you know, it should be pretty old hat, as it were.
Yeah, they know what they're doing with these early stages. They really have it down. It doesn't look like there's much of a challenge until the icicles come, and from what it appears to me, it's that the icicles are generated randomly, pseudo-randomly, based on little rules and stuff, and the position of the icicles and the timing for when they're going to fall is the major determiner for how they're going to set up certain groups and patterns and stuff. That and they're generating the fireballs by standing where they want them to appear. So it's like predictive movements that they're, you know, working with the flow of the things and where the enemies are going to resolve, like 4 or 5 seconds from now. They're all, you're always sort of playing to the future,
right?
Types of games.
Right. So to give everyone an update, it looks like Stephen Boyer's at 136,000. And Stephen, why do I always ruin his name? Kleisath is at around 90,000. I am sorry, Stephen Kleisath, because I'm probably butchering your name. But the fact of the matter is your gameplay is amazing.
Over and again.
What was that?
Over and over again.
Yeah, over and over again. And I don't mean to do that, because your gameplay deserves me saying your name correctly and the world knowing it, and not having to have it butchered by someone that is not very good.
That was Stephen Boyer's got a really excellent clear there. He anticipated the sidestepper turning purple to end the round and then reversed and managed to spam the points from the slip ice as well as the last coin. That was a really good clear for him.
I wanted to really quickly address everybody in the chat. I know that that you guys are probably experiencing a lot of lag, buffering issues, and I'm certainly sorry about that. We have done our very best to try to figure out the problem on our end. It's not normally like this, I assure you, and I am sorry for the technical difficulties. If we could fix it, we would. So thanks for sticking with us, and apologies again.
Record setter Josh, yes, I am the Cowabunga Breakfast. Cowabunga Book Fair, whatever you want to call it.
So Kleisath just unfortunately lost one of his lives. I heard him say, "What am I doing?"
Kleisath.
Sorry.
Everything to say when you lose a life.
Sorry. Kleisath.
Just think of it like the Kleisath star system.
So we've got Retroper says a few details that sometimes help in tight situations. You can run under fireflies. You can jump up right next to a fully formed icicle to make it fall down before it normally would. And you can actually run under green fireballs, but the timing is really tight.
It looks like there are specific places where the path of the green fireball is going to take it on a downward dip at exactly that moment. The middle platform on the extreme left and right hand side, and on the top of the POW block. It looks like Kleisath just sort of abandoned that. I'm not sure if the pattern of the fireball is always the same, but it looks like they can tell what it's going to do at their given safe point before they have to make that decision. So it's all sort of flow prediction again.
Well, the thing that's interesting to me, going back to the icicles point that you made earlier, as it starts to complicate things with the icicles, I when you get a number of icicles, And I'm sure probably when you're, like you explained earlier, being in the Zen mode, probably able to tell when they're going to drop. But as far as me just trying to figure it out, I'm like, I don't know when that thing's going to drop.
No,
you know,
you can figure out exactly when they're going to drop. Basically, what you're doing is watching. If something is appearing in your vicinity or in the vicinity of where you know you're about to be, whichever one.
There's another sort of. Do the icicles then slide on the platforms as well? Am I?
The icicles that appear hanging off the platforms fall down to the ground and will kill you if they touch you. The slide ice that goes around will slide around until it reaches. Let's see. There's a couple rules for the slider ice. If it touches an enemy and has to turn around, it'll stop in the middle and turn that platform icy. If both platforms are icy on the bottom, it looks like it'll just slide all the way into the pipe and out of the way. But if something bumps it and makes it weird in the middle of that, in the middle platform on the middle row, looks like it'll just sit there and turn the platform icy. So they're actually trying to looks like they're trying to slide all the way down to the bottom pipes and get out of there. But if they encounter a platform that isn't icy, they want it to be icy. And
okay.
It looks like since the top ones are starting out icy, there's really only the platform in the middle and the two on the bottom row on the extreme left and right. And obviously an icy platform will slow down your, will increase your deceleration a little bit, or it'll decrease it. You decelerate slowly when the platform is icy. You slow. I'm trying to be all complex about it. And that was good for Stephen Boyer. He just got right under that icicle that fell because he knew he was watching it, and he knew how much time he had.
What?
Wow. Yeah. I was just watching Boyer.
Sorry, 1 second. Let me finish this foot.
Just watching Boyer do some really crazy stuff down there in the corner. Wow.
He's gonna loop around. Yep. He's got those two to deal with. That blue crab is mad, so he knows he has to deal with that. He's got the fireball coming at him. That was good. He can hang out right there in the edge. The crabs will go into the pipe instead of hurting him, and he can jump to avoid the fireballs. It doesn't look like they hurt you when they're in that spiraling in generation phase animation.
Score update. By the way, Stephen Boyer just seems, and I don't want to jinx him, but he seems on fire right now, doing very well. He's at 243, just about 244,000. And Stephen Kleisath is at 188,000. So those of you just joining us, you may be experiencing some lag issues, and for that we apologize, but you are checking out two of the top Mario Brothers players in the world of all timesies. This is their third game this evening. Both of them have already reached over 1 million points in this classic game this evening. This is their tiebreaker session. Stephen Boyer and Stephen Kleisath are competing in a friendly competition, but of course each of them want to win. As I've said, this is their third game. In the first game, Stephen Boyer hit 563,000, while Stephen Kleisath hit 1.1 million. And then in the second game, it was Stephen Boyer who had 1.4 million. So far this evening, Stephen Boyer is the ultimate high scorer, but the goal for these gentlemen was to get over 1 million points in this game this evening in a live setting. They did that, both of them. If you are watching us from LeetLoungeLive.com, you can switch camera angles. However, we are automatically switching the camera angles this evening as well. We've also got Mason Kramer tuning in on our Skype array. You guys can do the same. If you go to LeetLoungeLive.com, you can Skype in with us and talk with us live. Mason, it was Super Mario Brothers 3 was your game, is that correct?
Where yes.
You were, you are the ultimate of ultimates. You cannot be any more ultimate than you in that game. There
well,
literally
I have, yeah.
can be no one better than you.
Well, you know, that. Thank you. I appreciate that. Of course, it's subjective. You know, well, you know, because, you, I mean, you get flack. You know, oh, I'm the best ever, you know. I like to do it, and I like to play. I got the max out score on Super Mario World a couple years ago. That's 10 million points, or 9,999,990, which is 10 million is just easier to say, so I say it. That's on one life. It was a deathless run and point pressed the game in ways that no one had done before. And
I was going to say that was under extreme settings, correct?
Yeah, that was a one life game. You can't repeat levels, and there was a certain technicality that was banned because it was a free point spam. In the end, I ended up figuring out that you can do a weird trick that's technical where you lock a shell at a specific combo value, so you can basically create a shell that, under the right circumstances, will score 8,000 points repeatedly or score one-ups or whatever other combo point value you want. The hitch of it is that you still have to be able to complete the level before the timer runs out, because the time will kill you on a one-life game. So there's
that.
Pretty much the same thing for Super Mario Brothers 3 on NES. The guy who has the world record on the game we're watching, Arcade Mario Brothers, Tom Vadova, it was his record on Mario 3 that I just beat, which was another deathless game using like optimized point pressing strategies.
So is there anything about Super Mario Brothers that you don't know at this point? Super Mario Brothers 3, or you're calling it Super Mario World, correct?
Well, Super Mario World was for Super Nintendo, and also Super Mario Brothers 3 on NES. So I have two separate. I have more records than that, but those are the two like big Mario records.
Well, please feel free to share all of them, as I can be schooled with your mastery of all of the games that you have. Because how do you keep track of all the world records you have and all the high scores you have?
Well, I have a list. That's gotta be
an awesome feeling to have a list of your greatest scores, because my greatest accomplishments are like I took a really great poo last Wednesday or something, you know? I don't have much to go on.
Well, if you want, I was kind of looking around for my notebook, but some of the noteworthy ones, I got the Mario World max out. I have the Mario 3 deathless high score. I got the world record on Atari 2600 Kool-Aid Man. No one had ever seen a
classic games to get better at them, and so on and so forth. Can anybody that dedicates the time be as amazing as you guys are? Or is there a special type of mentality, special type of person it takes to have that sort of payoff?
I say you have to have the motivation to do it.
Well, yes.
Yeah. You have to be willing to lose a lot. You have to be willing to put up with the frustration and to understand that this is going to happen slowly-ish. You know, you're going to play 10 games and you're going to get a good score maybe half the time if you're lucky. You know what I mean? You have to be really willing to not be too harsh on yourself to say, oh, well, I can't do this. It's like I said before, it's like you learn how to learn, and you learn principles and fundamentals of gaming, such as like button timing, frame precision, animation sequences. All of that is like can be applied to any game. So I think that there hasn't been much of a centralized push to talk about the metaphysics of playing games, if that makes sense. But I think that it's a sort of philosophy that can be articulated and can be like boiled down into core concepts. You know, we could talk about core guitar playing principles without having to talk about different styles of play. And we could talk about how principles build style and stuff. The same thing can be done for gaming, but I just don't know if anyone has done that yet. It's kind of something that I've sort of been thinking of in my head.
Well, that is a super interesting discussion to consider.
If we want, we could, you know, I could do collegiate level dissertations on jump mechanics and frame precision in Mario 3. You know what I mean? We could talk about button combinations, ways to hold the controller, frame precision, timing, or jump articulation, a million things. And it's all like this meta thing that you're doing. It's like martial arts is how I see it. You know, there's infinite number of ways to throw a punch, just like there's infinite number of ways to jump in a Mario game or something.
Right. I want to catch people up that are tuning in, as we are on the front page of Twitch. We've got Stephen Boyer at 334,000. He's still got two lives left. Earlier today, Stephen hit 1.4 million. We've got Stephen Kleisath is at 304,000. He earlier hit 1.1 million. They've both done that in a live setting today. This is their third game, sort of their tiebreaker in this this friendly competition, but still each of these guys is competitors that want to win. And we're really happy to be basically restreaming their streams for you, so you can check that out. These are two world-class players. We've got Mason Kramer in Lounge Live 1 on our Skype grid. You guys can Skype in with us at EliteLoungeLive.com. That's where you can switch camera angles. If you don't like the automatic switcher that is changing between the two different gameplays, you can do it yourself at EliteLoungeLive.com. So again, thanks everybody for tuning in. Thank you all for the support for these two awesome players and for supporting Classic Gaming.
I'm just completely screwed.
And Stephen Kleisath just unfortunately lost his.
Congratulations, Stephen Boyer.
Last man. He's just said. He's just said.
I was just saying, actually.
Congratulations to Stephen Boyer is what Kleisath. Oh wow! I can't believe how tired I am, and I just played like a really great game, and then I'll go to play another one, and it just keeps going downhill from there. And I keep thinking, no, I just had a good one. I should be able to do this.
So it's when you're tired, you're unhinged a little bit, so you feel more. You know, I can draw analogies between Enter the Dragon and video gaming forever. You know, when the kid comes up to Bruce Lee and he says, you know, he threw a punch at me and he says, how did that feel? He says, don't think, feel. That's like Zen gaming, you know what I mean? It's a feeling, and when you sort of unhinge yourself, you're tired, you're not thinking about it as hard, because overthinking can totally ruin it. You really want your hands to know what they're doing more than your mind, even.
Right. So guys, thanks in the chat for tuning in here. We've got the cool Chario, Archerman 19, of course, there, Barons, Roglis, Santana 6193, of course Wolfsten is there. Hey Wolf in Skype. There's Telebro creeping up there in Lounge Live 3. And of course, Mason Kramer up there hanging out with us. Mason, you've been here pretty much the whole night now.
Yeah, I've been here since about 9:30-ish.
Now, where are you located, Mason?
I'm in Pennsylvania, a little bit outside of Pittsburgh.
Oh, okay, cool. Side note, just in case you're curious, I'm from the Cleveland area, so we can be enemies.
Oh, cool. Yeah, I got some family out Cleveland way. I like it out there.
Excellent. Excellent. Very cool. I did not miss the winters. I'd like about 2 weeks of snow, but no, I don't really want to be there especially this winter. You guys have really had it rough.
Yeah, we got busted pretty hard, and I just moved out to the country too, so we got tons of snow.
Hey guys, thanks a lot. Thanks so much for watching. Thanks to 1337 Lounge for hosting us tonight. I hope we can do it again in the future, maybe get some other players involved. Stephen Boyer's still going strong, so I'm going to watch his stream. I'm going to watch the rest of his stream and keep mine up. And feel free to say hi in my chat box on my personal Twitch.
So Stephen Kleisath is just wrapping things up. He said he's going to check out Stephen's stream. Make sure you guys jump over. Wolf, if you can post links to their streams as well. If you check out Stephen Kleisath's stream, I know he was just saying he was going to jump in his chat and type to the fans, type to the folks there checking him out. Please give him all the support and congratulations today. An awesome performance. He finished his high score today was 1.1 million. His second game was 779,000, and I believe somewhere around 376,000 was his final score for the third game. So we really appreciate these guys making such an awesome effort and letting us restream their broadcasts here. Stephen Boyer is on his very last life. He's at 419,000. Just finish up a level there. Again, we're on a massive delay, and I know we've got some lag issues. Apologies for that. We are doing the very best we can, but thank you guys for checking us out as these two titans of classic gaming have been duking it out in Mario Brothers Classic, and boggling my mind with their amazing skill. And I'm sure putting pretty much all of us to shame, except for maybe Mason Kramer up there in Lounge Live 1.
This makes me really want to learn this game. I'm familiar with the NES version of this, and I've been to over 3 million on the NES port, which is much easier than this because of several reasons. The icicles don't fall, certain pattern variations, etc. but this makes me want to sort of get with this game and learn it. I don't, you know, I don't mean to overstep my boots or anything, but I think I could probably do a million or so on this with a little bit of work.
That was going to be one of the questions I had both for Stevens's and for you, Mason, was what kind of, you know, when you watch a game, what sort of things interest you about a specific game over another? Because there's tons of classic games that are at once similar and at once very different. So just curious, what kind of things drive you towards the games that you choose to master?
I really like games that are, I call them fluid, games that are... running patterns, games... I don't like games with, like... I call it, it's I've made up my whole sort of meta language to talk about games. I don't like games with irky mechanics. This game is sort of irky in the sense your character is like boing. Donkey Kong is a great example. Incredibly irky. That was a sweet move by Stephen Boyer there, avoiding that. I would play some Kaboom. I love Atari. That's my main thing. I'd be happy to do a game, Mario 3, Mario World, whatever. You know, I can do, like, I really practice because I like to perform. You know, I like, you know, I'm a musician and stuff. I like performing and doing tricks, so I practice my commentary run so I can, like, play the game and hold a conversation about it and stuff. Man, if that seems interesting to you, man, get a hold of me. If not, I'm not going to be offended, whatever, you know.
We love to support classic gaming. I mean, gaming of all shapes and styles. It's really funny talking about performing gaming because a few years ago, Jace went to a convention out here in L.A. called Kamikaze. And his whole goal was that he set up an Atari, and he played Kaboom, and he challenged anyone to beat him.
What kind of scores does he get?
In one game.
Do you know what Jace's Kaboom score is right now?
Jace claims that he has no upper limit, that he can go forever. That's what he claims.
Because it would max out, and I know about the 12th wave, it really gets hectic. That's cool. I mean, if he can get, you know, even approaching, like, 10,000 and up is a really good score, but, it would max out, you know. Hundreds of thousands, you know, 999999 max out a million is possible, at least. I know people have done it.
Well, he played over the course of this weekend every single challenger, and no one could beat him.
Do you know what kind of scores were?
I'm trying to remember. I remember he definitely got to the, I would say, Xander knows better than I do, because Xander was there with him. Yeah. Let me go bother Xander because I want to say it was close to 10,000, but I don't recall. So
10,000, the Easter egg pops up.
Let me go ask him real quick.
Yeah, there's the Mad Bomber will make a surprised face at 10,000 points. That was a really nice kick by Stephen Boyer there, hitting that crab right out of the way.
Yeah, Stephen Boyer is quickly approaching 500,000 here. This is his final game for the evening. We're talking and watching classic gaming here tonight, guys. We've got Mario Brothers, Stephen Boyer, and Stephen Kleisath were competing this evening to both get their goals. Personal goals were to get over a million points each during a live setting, which they both did this evening. Stephen Boyer hitting 1.4 million. Stephen Kleisath hitting 1.1 million. This is their final game. Unfortunately, Stephen Boyer is the only one left. He's on his last life, and he's just hit 500,000. Do you recall what Jace's best score was, Xander, during the Kaboom weekend of weekendness?
Oh, he just—he did not set out to set a high score. All he did was set out to beat everyone. So,
but do you recall what the highest you've ever seen him get is? Because you've seen him play more than
I've seen. I think the highest I've seen him is like in the 30,000s, something like that. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know. I'm sure. Yeah, what's the world record?
Well, the world record. 6 million Smash TV. And not all these are world records, but I'm just kind of looking up my list here.
So real quick, Mason, I definitely don't want to interrupt the list because I'm actually thinking you could probably go through an entire stream just reciting all of the games. But we've got the Maximum Steve in our chat, and I believe Maximum Steve is Stephen Kleisath. And Stephen, I'm sorry for ruining your last name this entire night, but thanks so much for doing this, for playing this game, for being awesome at this game, and for letting us show off the incredible game skill of yourself and Stephen Boyer. Speaking of which, Stephen Boyer is approaching 600,000. It's nerve-wracking because he doesn't have any more lives left. He has hit 1.4 million today. He is currently sitting at 585,000. Those of you just tuning in, that's what tonight was all about. Classic gaming, it's Mario Brothers classic arcade style with these two titans of classic gaming going at it, trying to hit 1 million points live. Each of them were successful in doing so. And so we're here at the last game watching Stephen Boyer try one more time to see how far he can go with his high score. And thanks so much for tuning in, guys. Check out LeetLoungeLive.com to be able to switch camera angles yourself if you don't like the automatic rotation of the camera angles. If you go to our website, you can change the camera angles yourself. And you can also Skype in with us, just like Mason's doing and Wolfsten's doing and Telebro, who's left his chair and just is an empty chair and makes me sad, are doing. So guys, thanks so much for giving these guys your support and checking out their awesome gameplay. So actually, you know what? I do want to stop the camera switching because we want to just stay on Steven's gameplay here. It just occurred to me that that would probably be the smart move. So I'm going to stop that and switch that over here.
Oh yeah, Mr. Kleisath, congratulations, man. You played very well. I like watching you.
So there it is. There, Stephen Boyer just hit 600,000. He's at 619,000. Kleisath is saying he's got 2 million is next. That's great to hear. We hopefully we'll be able to check that out as well when you go for that. It'd be awesome to do that live. Now, is there an upper limit to this game that is known currently, Mason? Is there, because I see he's on phase 67?
No.
57?
As far as I know, this game doesn't have a kill screen, meaning that once you get to round 99, it will loop. On the NES version, it doesn't have a kill screen either. The rounds will loop after 99. You'll actually hit a round 0, and the game will continue on, and you'll just say round 1, even though you know that's round 101.
Right,
as,
okay.
As I know, there's no upper limit. I believe the current world record is held by Tom Vadova, and it's somewhere past 4 million points. I don't know the exact number, but I could look that up. Look it up, considering some of the references are a little sketchy. But, I think Tom Vadova's got it at 4 million some. I don't think it would kill screen, but then again, you don't get any extra lives. You have the 4 lives to play with, and that is it. I believe it's 4, unless I screwed up.
Yeah, I believe you're correct about that. Maximum Steve, Stephen Kleisath is pointing out that he also has the number 3 score in the world in Turbo Miss Pac-Man, which is pretty awesome. That's another game that actually Jace Hall, who we've talked about a number of times. Jace is the owner of this lounge and of HD Films and is my boss and is the guy who created this whole space here that I'm sitting in. He has a fierce competition with three-time NBA world champion Rick Fox. Rick Fox comes in here and plays Miss Pac-Man against Jace, and they have a fierce competition, a fierce rivalry between them. So that's another game that...
Is Turbo Miss Pac-Man is the name
I
of it?
I think it's the way Turbo. I know, I think it's the Turbo Miss Pac-Man. That's why I'm...
way different than the regular. Turbo Miss Pac-Man, is, in my opinion, it's a little bit easier, but... That's it. There's one arcade machine in town is the Pac-Man, Miss Pac-Man down at the bar, but it's not Turbo.
I'm pretty sure it's Turbo. Of course, could be confusing.
It's been about 3/4. Is anybody, you guys kill screening Turbo Miss Pac-Man? I think it kills at like 126, and there's a couple weirdism levels. I myself have been to about 100, so I just don't have access to a machine that often.
Oh, okay, so Steve's top 15 scores in Mario Brothers.
Oh, thank you, Steve.
Yeah, thank you, Steve, for posting those for us. 4.6 million. Wow.
That's not bad. Probably. I would guess. I mean, how long did it take to get a million? About an hour. It's a 4 or 5 hour game ish on four lives. Not out of the question. It's beatable. You know.
That's amazing. Wow.
Two.
Man, kind of battle you got to go through to get that.
Just don't screw up ever.
Now, Mason, and now that we also have Steven in the chat, maybe you could break this down a little bit for me, because I'm curious. Obviously, there are 99 phases in this game, or so we believe at this point, or I believe at this point, I should say.
Just that the numbers go up to 99.
Do they, within that 99, do the level patterns repeat? Because I know we've been talking a lot about patterns and things like that.
Yeah, I believe there's a repeating set of patterns, not in like what's going to, like a repeating set of enemies that are going to come at you, or the level has a particular template. I'm not exactly sure, but it seems like they're
at 1.4 million on his second game. Steven Kleisath hit 1.1 million on his first game. They both did it live. And we want to thank them both for their incredible effort and showmanship today. This is pretty intense to see the classic gaming skill displayed for the world to see. So we are sorry about the lag, as DudeGuy231 has pointed out. But thank you all for tuning in for this. I feel like we've got to figure out what we're gonna do next, because we're sitting here with this awesome. How do you follow up 2 1-million scores in Mario Brothers? Thank you guys so much, Steven. Both Stevens, if you'd like to post links to your individual streams, or maybe Wolfsten could do that for you, because you may get banned if you post your links, because you wouldn't get banned, you just get blocked. Because it's just automatic, it just does that. But we are merely humble servants of gaming in general. Thank you guys for showing off your awesome gameplay here this evening. Mason, thank you for your insight into all this, for tuning in, for keeping us company and letting us not be total noobs to not know what we're talking about. So we're so happy to have you here with your knowledge and your insight.
Thank you for having me, man.
Oh, of course. Well, this is available anytime, guys. You guys want to Skype in with us, it's always here. We're broadcasting 24/7 in the lounge. The Skype array is always open. You can chat live with us. You can switch camera angles at EliteLoungeLive.com. You can hopefully not suffer lag on any given day, but today, unfortunately, was a laggy day. And you can also check out our schedule. We've got some cool stuff coming up this weekend. Earlier this week, we had MMA superstar Kung Lee was in here playing some games, promoting his new movie. Oh, look, Xander Denke's back. Xander, it happened.
What happened?
Stephen Boyer went down, unfortunately.
Oh, no. 684,000. 684 on the last one. So technically, Stephen took the night. Like 2 out of 3, would you say?
Regardless, that sentence would have been correct, no matter how you said that. Stephen took the night, as there were two of them.
It That's
was
right.
The Battle of the Steves.
Yes, it was the Battle, of the Steves.
Yes, but Stephen Boyer ended up.
It does sound like they're both tired. As Stephen Boyer's already like, we can catch up tomorrow.
Oh yeah, I bet you guys are exhausted, especially on those. I mean, the stress when you were down to one life. Now I'm self-conscious about saying Kleisath.
Right. Because I screwed it up a number
of
times.
So Maximum Steve, I like that one better, and Stephen Boyer. Maximum Steve was down to one life, like at 500,000. And then he continued on and pushed it all the way to 1,108,000 in that first game.
Wow.
And really had a stellar game. But seeing that level after level, for you guys, you must have been stressed. Like, if you get hit, you're done.
Yeah.
And same thing with Stephen Boyer, really pushed it. Like he had a one life buffer and was able to kind of push it a little bit. But man, when he got down to it and was cranking up there in the after the million.
Well, and I assume, you know, I mean, these guys are professionals. They do this all the time. But you know, you got to think that it's not so much like the disappointment of. In my mind, I'm thinking like, oh man, I just that's such a long. this is a journey to get here. I gotta start the journey all over again. To do it again. But you know, with these guys, they just they know they've got that that skill that they can come back to at any given time. And Stephen Boyer says, my finger hurts.
Because it's just, you only have one button. Just move and jump.
Oh, well, thanks for clearing that up, Xander. I thought he was using his rocket fist there.
It was a rocket fist.
Yeah.
That's what he really was using.
Super rocket punch.
There's the setup. There's the cabinet. Nice. Wow. And you see where he was sitting?
Had his camera like right next to him.
I can hear him typing too. So he's typing to us. You just signed into Skype. Do I have to call you guys? Oh, Steve, you do not. Just go to EliteLoungeLive.com and click on 7 or 8 right now, and you'll cam in.
Yeah. So we have 8 cameras that you can call in from with Skype. 6 of the 8 are full, so only 7 and 8 are open right now. So call 7 or 8. It's LoungeLive 7 or LoungeLive 8. No spaces. Just type it in just like that into Skype to call us, or click on one of those blue buttons on EliteLoungeLive.com. Call us, and you will talk to everybody live.
I kind of want to be embarrassed and play. I want to play on our
embarrass yourself?
And play Mario Brothers. Everyone how hard it is.
I'm too scared.
And how skilled these fine gentlemen are.
No, that's scary. I don't want to embarrass myself that much. We'll run to the restroom real quick.
We can just barely hear you.
Okay.
Oh,
there you are.
There we go. Yeah.
How's it going, guys?
Great. How are you?
A little tired, but doing good.
Who called in? Kleisath. Is that how you say it?
Yeah, Kleisath.
Yeah. So Stephen Kleisath has just called in on Lounge Live 7. Welcome. Congratulations. Man, that first game you had, the 1,102,890 point game, you were rocking it there with on your last life. You just kept going, and it was nerve-wracking.
Yeah, I figured I finally got into a groove. It's weird. Sometimes you sort of finally get into that zone later than sooner.
Okay.
Which should be sooner than later. And I finally got into a comfortable zone, and I was like, you know what? Even though it's the last man, I've gone as far as 600,000 or 700,000 on one man before, so I knew I could do it. Just had to hunker down and not make any petty mistakes.
Which you did. You pretty much did go about 600,000 on your lap. Now this.
Zander, you're cutting out.
What?
Your mic is cutting.
Is it still cutting out? Now?
It was just fuzzy for a second. It's all right.
Okay, maybe.
Yeah, it had been cutting out.
Okay. And now it's okay?
Yeah, you're good.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I'm out, guys.
So there you go. You're back and no longer a robot. For those, because our numbers just bumped up, I wanted to tell the people who are just watching, what you missed was a classic Mario Brothers arcade game, Mario Off, where two amazing players, Stephen Boyer, who is third in the world, and Stephen Kleisath, who is fifth in the world, they went head-to-head, streaming from their various homes, and went for 3 rounds, did incredibly well. It was very close. And right now in Lounge Live 7, we have this wonderful Skype system. If you aren't familiar, you should see it right now in Cam 7. But he is Skyped in to Lounge Live 7, and we're talking with him. How are you feeling right now?
I'm feeling okay. Like, I can actually play again, but the way we designed it was just go 3 games apiece, and then, you know, whatever happens, happens.
Whatever happens, happens.
A little tired initially after that. On the 3rd game, I definitely got into a bind early, and it was probably a little bit of fatigue there. But now that I haven't played in a little while, I'm a little bit more coherent.
now on your arcade there, because you have an original arcade, correct?
Yeah, I have the Mario Brothers arcade cabinet. It's and by the way, something that wasn't said, I think, the whole night, it was medium difficulty setting. on the dip switch bank.
Got it. Thank you. Yeah, we were wondering about that, but we didn't have a way to really communicate with you.
Of course. Yeah.
What does medium dip switch? What does medium difficulty entail? Bonus life threshold or enemy wave starting or what?
It's just when TwinGalaxies set the high score for Mario Brothers when they had the scoreboard up. For some reason, even though the default setting is easy, they only counted the medium difficulty setting as an official record.
Yeah, I was just wondering what's different about that.
Okay, so
there's a dip switch on the board, and there's like little flaps, and it goes like 1 to 8 or 8 through H.
Okay.
And depending on what flap is up or down, that will change the difficulty level of the gameplay. So you actually have easy, medium, hard, and very hard. And the standard is medium as far as the official scoreboard.
Okay.
Right, what are just like, can you tell us about the differences in gameplay? Like what changes in the game?
Easy. When you see that green fireball on medium, the second one comes out usually pretty close after the first one.
Okay.
On easy, you sort of have a little more time in between the two green fireballs as they're going through the screen. And then when you get to hard and very hard, they come out even quicker.
Right. Now Kat is pointing out that you've gone robot again. I wonder if you just need to turn your volume down a little bit, that there might be a bit of feedback. A little bit.
I just turned the volume down on my speakers.
Yeah, that's a little bit better. Yeah. Okay, so you were on the official
to acknowledge and sort of have a re-interest in this classic game, because if it's not for Mario Brothers, you don't have Super Mario Brothers. You know, the pipes, the turtles, the fireballs, all those aspects were originally on this game. And of course, Super Mario Brothers is widely known as obviously one of the most popular games of all time. But it all came from this game, and we think it deserves its rightful spot right alongside Donkey Kong and the other greats as a classic Mario game where Mario.
I agree with you.
I would agree too. It was a great showcase tonight of the game, because when I asked somebody earlier, when you say Mario Brothers, what do you think of? And everyone always thinks of Super Mario Brothers, the very, you know, the first NES title. But this definitely was the precursor. It set the stage for the characters, and you know, Mario had always been present in Donkey Kong and others, but. Yeah, it was really great. So you tonight got 1.1 million, and your best is 1.4. I mean, you were right on pace.
Yeah, I'm really trying to get to 2 million. Where it's, and of course, Stephen Boyer, he has gotten 2 million a couple times before. So it is possible, like the one guy was saying, the Tom Bava record, it's not probable, but it is possible. That's a pretty crazy score. I mean, he in that 4 million game, I think he went like two men, like all the way to 3 million on just two men, two of the four men, because you only get one extra man.
Yeah, that's interesting to note. Other people are used to, you know, getting on some of their games an extra man every so many lives, but you only get one extra life at 20,000, and that is it. And 20,000 points is a lot. It's very far away from a million. So.
Yeah, exactly.
Very difficult.
You can actually set the dip switch bank, or the dip switches,
sure,
to get up to six men.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Up to five men and then an extra, and you can play either easy, medium, hard, or very hard with six men.
Right.
But it's just all of the dip switches.
Yeah, but that's not acceptable tournament or world
exactly.
record play. So we appreciate. Right. Well, you know, if you wouldn't mind, would you mind trying, like, hanging up and calling back on Lounge Live 8? I'm not sure if it's line 7 or just maybe your mic. I can't quite tell. Would you mind trying that for us, Stephen?
Yeah, I'll hang up and I'll call back on number 8.
Call back 8. Thank you. Yeah, if you're just joining us, we were talking with Stephen Kleisath, who played tonight. His score is 5th in the world in Mario Brothers, the original arcade game, which you can see being played there, just kind of back and forth the title screen. The original Mario and original Luigi, before they were Koopas and, you know, fireballs, they were shell creepers, side steppers, fighter flies, and slip ice. And it was very cool to see them. The high score tonight was from Stephen Boyer, who hit 1,495,110 on the second round. Stephen Boyer is, of course, second in the world with a, or third in the world with a score just over 2 million.
All right, I'm back, guys.
Ah, there we go. That sounds much better.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. No more RoboCop?
No more Robo Steve. So, guys, if you have any questions, I can shoot them both at Stephen and... Stephen Boyer is in the chat, so he said two of my games tonight were wasted because I died and had to drop back down into a mess. The game is totally brutal, but great. And Stephen, unfortunately, does not have Skype installed. but we have time, so if you want to, you could absolutely do that. The other thing is, so if you guys have any questions... We've been trying to do this more, which is put a showcase on classic arcade gaming. Of course, we have here the ultimate game machine that we have custom built. It has 45 emulators right now, and we're trying to expand it into a LAN party Mario Brothers edition.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I'd have to, obviously, it would be through Maine, like where Steve is playing on tonight. I mean,
right.
Right now, I have a webcam set up, you know, looking or viewing the arcade cab. Tripod. So
excuse me. Yes. Yeah, exactly. I have heard of that also, the online MAME play that you can play together against each other from a distance. That's what you're talking about?
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
The real way to play is together, but for fun you could play against each other too.
Yes. That would be a lot of fun.
And then there's a couple other guys that would like to, because we just want to keep getting the word. I mean, not getting the word, I guess re-getting the word. It's a classic game about Mario, the importance of Mario Brothers, just like Donkey Kong with the documentaries and stuff. Because there's a couple other pretty savant players that we know who are creating a lot of classic arcade games, like Benjamin Falls and Perry Rogers and,
uh-huh.
and others who would love to come on and do maybe even more players in a Mario Off in the future. You know, the reason I got the name was really from the Kong Off. Because Richie Knuckles holds the Kong Off every year.
Right, right.
And just for reference, I think this year's Kong Off, there's going to be a Mario Off side event at the event, so it should be pretty cool.
Excellent. And are you planning on entering?
Yeah, I'll be there. I'll definitely be there.
Now, where is this year's? Is the Kong Off in the same city every year?
No, the last 2 years it was in Denver.
Okay.
And I believe this year it's going to be in Flemington, New Jersey, at Richie's Arcade in New Jersey.
Okay, in New Jersey is where the Kong Off will be. Okay.
Well, this year, yeah. I don't know what the dates are yet. I think Richie's just working hard on getting cabinets ready, and I'm sure he'll make an official announcement when they figure out what the dates are.
Well, I know. I heard Adam Rady mentioning it. We definitely would love to play on or to get a hold of a Zookeeper cabinet.
That'd be awesome.
It's such a fun game.
Stephen Boyer needs to chime in with that. I think you would know where to get that.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting right now in Glendale, they're auctioning off a bunch of old arcades, old cabinets, and I think Miss Pac-Man is there, and Galaga is there as well.
And actually, I'd like to give one more plug, too, because my friend Robert Childs, he runs a shop called Arcade Game Sales here in Fort Lauderdale, Florida.
Okay.
And it's basically a repair shop most of the time, where he builds cabinets, refurbishes, buys and sells games. But I actually host an event. It used to be once a month, but we just moved into a new facility, and it's going to start being weekly. We actually do an event called Retro Arcade Night. And what it is it's just a flat fee at the door, and then it's all you can play all night. And we have about 100 machines.
Wow.
So it's a very cool event. If anybody's ever in South Florida, definitely look it up. It's Arcade Game Sales. I think the website's arcadegamesales.net or .com, and of course I have a Facebook page.
Okay.
But Robert Childs is actually, he used to be partners with Billy Mitchell for the King of Kong Arcade in Orlando, Florida.
Okay.
Okay.
They've actually sold that recently. So, you know, Billy's there all the time. Some other the older, you know, classic players stop in from time to time, Todd Rogers, Chris Ayra. So, but it's a really cool event and sort of gives, you know, we have about, well, the new facility, we're going to be able to fill like 100 machines. So it would be nice to have a zookeeper. We actually don't have a zookeeper. We have about everything else, though.
Well, it looks like, yeah, Stephen just said zookeepers are pretty rare and break down a lot.
Yeah, it's very similar to Tempest, right, Stephen Boyer?
Does that just pop off?
Well, it's Tempest.
Tempest breaks down a lot, too.
Which, yours breaks down, your Mario Brothers? Oh, Tempest.
Oh, no, Mario Brothers. I said the game Tempest is similar, like Zookeeper. It tends to, you tend to have to work on it a lot.
Okay. Yeah. Well, you're both of your gameplay tonight. Congratulations to both of the Stevens for playing some amazing games. If you're just tuning in, you missed some great games. You should go back and check our archive because they played very well. We did have some connection problems, so our archive might be kind of rough, but
you know, we're going to ask you guys about that. If we wanted to go back and watch it, do you
well, yeah, we'll highlight it and put it on the on our just Twitch channel, so you'll be able to see it. We'll definitely let you know. I know Jennifer's in contact with you, so
awesome.
Let's see. Well, Wolfsten made a great comment. Congrats to both of you. Hope to see more epic gaming in the future. Yeah, we really appreciate you working hard on those three rounds. And you definitely impressed with that first round. Really, really giving it a great go.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate it. And we're honored to be a part of the you guys' lounge, and we hope to do it again sooner than later if you guys will have us. So.
Yeah, definitely. Looks like Steven's mentioning that you'd like to try another one with four players or more. Well, you can see our setup. We've got it set up that we could have quite a few players.
Yeah, that's what we were thinking about after we saw the setup. We're like, oh, wow, we could. Because I know there's like two or three other guys who are also Savant Mario Brothers guys that would love to chime in and compete with us. So.
Yeah, I wish I could somehow turn the switch on and become a Savant Mario Brothers player because it's a lot of fun. It's a fun game. But I think
just take some practice.
Yeah, I'll have to work up past the 10,000 mark before I can hit the million.
I'm sure you can.
and clearly Florida was a hot spot of arcades because you definitely have bred a lot of great
events that may be happening. Try to look for an event that's going to happen around where you live because there's tons of events throughout the United States. Like there's a tournament in Chicago about to go on right now. That's a classic, show or tournament. You have the California Extreme. You have some South Florida. We're going to start hosting events, and obviously in the Northeast around the Richie Knuckles area.
Well, that's very cool. I think that's great advice. You should definitely. Definitely check it out because it sounds like, and most of those, you got to remember that classic arcade gaming only costs a quarter per game, right?
Yeah. You see, back in the day, you couldn't afford not to. Excuse me, guys. You couldn't afford not to be good.
That's right. Because some of those were definite quarter suckers, and you had to be good.
That's right. Cost-effective to be good.
Yes, cost-effective. That's definitely true. Very, very true.
How to play.
I just posted a link to Donkey Kong Forum for you.
Thanks, Wolfsten. So Wolfsten posted Donkey Kong Forum there.com, and you can follow the streams of both the Steves, both Stevens, which is Maximum Steve. Who is Stephen Kleisath, who we're just speaking with. And then Stephen Boyer is in the lounge as well. And his is Stephen underscore Boyer. And it's the twitch.tv address there if you want to catch them. Do you try and stream every once in a while there, Stephen?
Yeah, I stream regularly. Actually, I have two arcade cabinets in my house, and one, of course, is Mario Brothers. The other one is Ms. Pac-Man. So I usually vary between those two.
Okay.
Lately, I've been on Mario Brothers because I've been eclipsing the million mark, and now I'm halfway to 2 million, so I sort of want to keep the momentum going for now. But
well, yeah, so
yeah,
you're...
periodically, me and Stephen Boyer both stream. Stephen basically just streams Mario Brothers. But I'll stream different games, Ms. Pac-Man and some other games at the, not in my house, but at the arcade if I ever get the setup. So. Stephen Boyer just pointed out he has a 2 million point save game. Oh, you know what? Actually, that's right. If you go to on DonkeyKongForum.com, there's a section that says other high scores besides Donkey Kong. And if you click it on, you can see the top 15 Mario Brothers score. It's a section that says Mario Brothers high score list. And some of the scores, if you click on the score, it'll go to the Twitch game. It'll go to the recording of that game. You guys can hear me okay at this point.
Yeah, sorry about that. I'm actually stepping in for Xander really quick. My name is Adam, by the way, Stephen. Congratulations. I was watching the second half of you guys' second game and the third game you guys were playing. We got a lot of stuff going on in the lounge here, obviously, and we're really excited to have you guys be in here. I was curious personally how long you guys have been going at this. This may have been a question you answered earlier, but obviously I know tonight you were going at it. But, I mean, since... You know, how old were you when you started doing this?
I mean, I played it when it first came out. It just sort of, I was actually able to visit an arcade, and it was there. And then when I was
a classic gaming, Mason.
Yeah, how about that?
All right, okay. Sorry about that. Sorry for my vernacular slur there. I was just curious. Do you guys ever get to communicate?
Do this sign.
Do you guys ever get to meet each other face to face? Are there classic gaming conventions that you guys get to go to, or is there any way for you guys to interact in person? Because obviously you're spread throughout the country at this point.
Right. Me and Steven have talked a bunch over the last like year, but we haven't actually met in person yet. But you know, we plan to soon. Probably at the con off this year, maybe, or something like that. Some of the other gamers that I've met through some of the different events that happened throughout the year. The Kong Off, the last Kong Off was back in November at a venue called the One Up. It's in downtown Denver, and I flew out to that. But I flew out to do the Ms. Pac-Man side event. It was actually me and Sam Miller were going for the world record in Turbo Ms. Pac-Man. He actually got the world record. And of course, you know, Ms. Pac-Man, you got to be lucky.
Can you tell me?
High quality fruit down the stretch, but. And so I met a lot of people at that I had been talking to for a while but hadn't physically met at that last panel.
What is the Turbo Miss Pac-Man world record? Do you know ballpark offhand? 900,000 something, I'm assuming.
It's Sam Miller unofficially has it because the Twin Galaxies, well, it's official, but he got it when the scoreboard's been down, but it's a 947,340, I think.
947. That's good. That's good. So we still haven't seen a million point Miss Pac-Man in any capacity then.
Not in Turbo, no. And that would be almost impossible. I mean, you'd have to have so much high quality bananas throughout the whole game.
Yeah, that's just that counter running over that when you eat the trigger dot, you time it out to trigger a banana. So I was just curious. I play regular Miss Pac-Man at the bar because I don't have access to a Turbo machine. I was just curious.
I have the Miss Pac-Man stand up. Okay, but I have the Turbo chip in the board.
Nice.
My highest score is 901,000 and something. So I have broken 900,000, but yeah, 947 is the highest score. And my score would be number three. The number two score now had actually held up as number one for about 12 years. It's a guy named Victor Kunasada who unfortunately passed away this past year. He was a little older at that point, but.
What are your scores like on non-turbo? I'm just curious. I'm not even trying to grill you. I just want to see how I stack
right.
up. I have about 125,000 was my best on regular non-turbo Ms. Pac-Man.
Regular Ms. Pac-Man, I think I've gotten just shy of 500,000.
That's good,
man. Nice. Something, I think, before, but I haven't played, like, I haven't played factory speed, as I call it, Ms. Pac-Man in a while, though. But Turbo Ms. Pac-Man in some ways is easy, but actually after about 500,000, when the coaster is as fast as you are, you know, there's a little margin of error on what you, you know, at certain points of the board.
Yeah, I've been to about 100 levels on Turbo Ms. Pac-Man-ish. And that's even losing count, but like I said, I don't have a chance to play it that often. I was just kind of curious how you're...
I
don't get a chance to talk to a lot of, like, arcade. You know, I don't have access to the arcades. You know, I got my Millipede machine that I'm fixing up, but other than that, you know, I just got to play what I can get, you know?
The interesting thing about Ms. Pac-Man is that you may not get a kill screen. Sometimes you'll get the last board and it'll just reset. Other times, you get up to like 8 kill screens, so you never know, it's random.
Yeah, that weird upside down invisible board and the backwards stuff. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I've been to it. It's good to have an extra man, because on some machines, if you lose a man, then the board becomes right side up on the next man.
That's weird. I didn't know that.
Yeah, on some versions.
Yeah.
I actually stepped off the screen for a second. I'm just trying to fix a technical glitch here, as we've had a few this evening, most notably all of the lag we've been suffering, and apologies for that to everybody that's been watching, as well as the competitors this evening, because
you know of the whole scene, of the whole you know, arcade hobby, to be able to post scores again and to interact with people, everybody, you know, equally the love of gaming, but you know, I guess it's a case by case basis depending on what area you're in, maybe, but in South Florida I've definitely seen spurts of growth.
Well, talking about
I guess Stephen Boyer had typed in the chat box, but I'll, in case people aren't looking at the chat, he wants to get $3 million on Mario Brothers and $1 million on a Donkey Kong.
Okay. All right.
I thought he had got $1 million, Stephen Boyer, on Donkey Kong.
I've got goals.
What'd you say? You've got
goals? They're not, you know, I'm working, if you want, I mean, because you asked me, if you're interested, I don't want to talk your ear off about this crap, you know, who am I, just some guy, but, I'm working, you know, I'm doing console stuff. I enjoy the consoles because that's what I grew up with and that's what I have access to. You know, I'm working on, I got a millipede machine recently. It's sitting here. I'm working on getting that fixed up so I can start to go for the tournament record on that. I'm working on NES Tetris. I got a 5.0.
Mason, can I just interrupt real quick? Steven, I think, do you happen to have a set of headphones, like even if they're earbuds with a mic on them?
I don't think so, actually, but let me do something real quick.
Okay. Yeah, because we're getting back some of what we're talking, so we're hearing Mason double up in your Skype when he's talking.
So I might mute my thing when I'm talking. I don't know if maybe you're getting feedback from my mic.
No, now that fixed it. You did, that fixed it, yeah.
Is this better now?
You're still a little bit of a robot. You may want to try hanging up and coming back, but it definitely was better on the front. When I talk, I'm not hearing back.
Okay, you want me to call back on the 7?
Yeah, or try...
He said try 3, because Xander, your mic went again.
I should try 3?
No.
Okay, sorry. Okay, I'll try 3. All right.
Okay.
Oh, but oh. I can now hear me myself again.
That may be coming from 2.
Yeah, that may be coming from you, Shiny Butt, or I can't remember. There we go. That's better. So you were saying, Mason, you were putting all your goals.
Yeah. Goals, you know, I'm one of the things, I have, like real score goals, and I have, like, meta goals in terms of, like, what do I want to accomplish with scores, and what do I want to accomplish in gaming in general. Scores, I could just give you the rundown forever. Destroy Atari. Destroy everything on Atari. Crush, kill, destroy. NES. I want to go back and do a full run of Mario 3 Deathless. The last run I did glitched out because I set a cup down next to the console and it glitched. For gaming itself, like, I want to start talking about the meta strategy. We were talking about that before, is like the meta gameplay fundamentals and stuff like that. Like, are you asking for, like, goals, like, with scores and stuff? Because, you know, I could start naming names. I like to be a performer. You know, I consider what I do a form of performance art. It's not even, like, this score is an art piece. It's a deliberately choreographed, it's formulated thing that's random and improvisation and all this other stuff, but it's art, you know. I like playing music, you know. There's no difference in my mind between playing my guitar and playing a video game, even though there's, you know, two different usages of the word playing. Scores, you know, Atari, I'm working on tons of stuff for Atari. I'd like to sort of bring back competitive 2600 a little bit. I'd really like to get a Tetris Max out within the year, maybe, if I'm lucky. That probably won't happen within the year, but who knows. You know, I want a Tetris kill screen and this and that, and you know, I like to play obscure games and new games and anything that kind of, you know, strikes my fancy. Well, not new games. I misspoke. I meant, like, obscure games.
Well, on the front of new games, I'll have to say that I've been playing a lot of arcade games here, and we have, just for fun and competing with one another, nowhere on the level of you guys, but I will say playing them does make you a better gamer.
I think learning like practicing Tetris is like sharpening all skills for gaming. Like, there's something about Tetris, man. NES Tetris, something about that. You know, the Thor Ackerland level 30 max out thing. You know, that's like godlike, and it's just it's so zen, and it's so Tetris is a state of mind.
Right.
You know, you hear competitive players talk about, well, say that they'd say I've been to a million points, as if a million points is a place. It is a place. It's a psychedelic manifestation sort of thing. It's a trip. You know, 6 million points is a mental place that you go to, you know, quasi physically, that kind of thing.
I was going to say to Steven, so your camera right now, it's kind of showing a piece of your arcade cabinet. You should just turn that so we could see you.
Give me a second.
Yeah, and I don't know why, but we're just with your mic, we're having the worst time with you, Sir Kleisath.
How am I sounding now?
Now you sound like you're really far away.
I have to say, Tetris was one of my all-time favorite games. That in, I really love Dig Dug.
It's Mario as the NBA logo.
Dig Dug, yes. I wish they had an NES port of Dig Dug. There's no decent port of Dig Dug on anything, and I wish I could play the arcades. I don't like MAME because I don't like the keyboard setup thing and the plug-in controllers. Controller is like it for me with gaming. It has to be the correct controller. It has to feel a certain way, the original hardware, that kind of thing. You know, I'm not like a Nazi purist, but I am a purist in that, like, I like it to be the way
to have
the experience.
I think you'd like the feel of our arcade cabinet here, the way that it.
Yeah, if you've got the, you know, the potentiometer twist paddles and the trackball and everything. I'm working. I was so stoked when I rebuilt. I got a millipede machine from a guy that was selling one in the classifieds, and I was so stoked to bring it home. And we got new rollers for the trackball, and the motherboard needs some new RAM chips, but we're working on fixing it up. And ever since I got the trackball rebuilt, I just like stand there and I just roll it now. I just like doing this. It just feels so good.
Three rounds between two Stevens, Steven Boyer and Steven Kleisath, both in their respective states. And you can see Steven Kleisath there in one of our cameras. He had up his arcade cabinet that he had, and Steven Boyer was playing on MAME, on a emulator. And they did very well. Steven Boyer ended up taking the evening by winning 2 out of 3 rounds, but also getting the high score of the night with 1,495,110. But Steven Kleisath was very close with 1,102,890. And that was very close to Steven's top score, which is 5th in the world, which is a 1.4 million around there. So his goal, he was saying to us earlier, was that his guest, his goal is to break the 2 million mark.
Hopefully sooner than later.
Well, if your first game was any indication, it seems like you could definitely get to that get to that mark soon. So if you guys have any questions about classic arcade gaming or anything else,
I have a question for both the players. What I noticed both of you guys really neglecting point pressing with the coins. Is there a reason other than your style, or is that just sort of how you do it? Because it looked like you guys, like, you would either let coins hang out until you could catch them, or you would not try to point press with them by getting them. Is that just sort of a safety factor, or what? I'm just curious. I'm not trying to criticize or grill you.
Oh, no, that's a good question. And, you know, there's also boards you can point press the Iceman. The first time that the Iceman come out, the moving ice, not the icicle.
Yeah, it seems like both of you guys were really interested in just clearing boards. That seemed to be your modus. Is there a reason, or is that just sort of longevity will see the day, you know?
The reason being there is no kill screen in Mario Brothers, so really there's no need to really point press unless you're just doing it for fun, just to, you know,
yeah,
do some new hijinks, so to speak. Because, like in Donkey Kong, it's understandable why people point press, because you have a timer on each board.
Yeah.
You know, you have a certain amount of points you know you're going to need to get to get the score at the end that you want to get. Whereas in Mario Brothers, it can go apparently just infinitely. I mean, Tom Bada scored over 4 million points, and there still is no fill screen, so...
Now, do you think, now, because I haven't seen, I've seen Tom Vadova's highlight video that he has on his YouTube channel of his 4.6 million game, and he doesn't, I mean, Vadova's a calculations wizard, but do you think he has do you have, like, an optimum pace calculated per score that just figures in clearing boards, or do you think it would be worth it to incorporate some point pressing moves into your overall pace recognition? I don't know if I'm saying this correctly.
The game on YouTube was actually his 3.6 million game. He'd just be carrying.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
The 4.6, I don't think there's recording of the 4.6 actually, but some of the hits and patterns I do are similar to some of the stuff Tom does. But I do point press sometimes. I actually didn't really point press tonight, but those phases after the second bonus level, which is the first bonus that you see ice, but before the bonus levels disappear, there's like 6 boards after that, and sometimes I point press on all 6 of those boards, ice men. And you can do it for a while, and then if you hit a pal, you can keep the red fireball slow, so you can continue to point press for a while. And that's something I do, because I know Stephen Boyer, Ben Falls, who's, by the way, hey Ben, he's on with us now, another awesome Mario Brothers player. They've watched me point press before, so I do it sometimes. Tonight I didn't do it because I just wanted to, you know, like you said, just get through it.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, because there's no kill screen and there's no timer.
Sure.
Sometimes trying to, I call it greed. Like you were saying, you leave coins sometimes. If it's going to be a 50-50 or risk play, then I just leave it alone and finish the board usually.
Yeah, you guys were very good with flow prediction. I noticed when you would actually clear the board instead of waiting for those 2 other coins and getting yourself into a bad spot. I was just curious about that, because I know on games without a kill screen, you know, longevity, just clearing boards can eventually, you know, get whatever score you want. So I was just curious how much you value, you know, point pressing the little things, those 2 extra coins or the couple extra icicles here and there.
Gotcha.
Just curious.
Because I'm going to use the pal. And if I use the pal, I'll be able to catch some of the coins, like hit some of the coins that may have passed me slightly when I
Yeah, because pal will just get any coins that are on the ground unless they're falling, right?
Yeah, they got to be solid on the ground. Same with like.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, I wanted to.
That's a good question. Those are all good questions.
I wanted to interrupt with my version of a good question, which is actually probably a very bad question because I'm asking it, and my knowledge is nowhere near you guys's. But that's kind of what my question is based off of, is that, Steven, you've been playing these games, like you said, since they came out. And I'm curious, do these strategies that you develop, are they natural developments of having played the game, learning the game, the patterns, and the flow? Or do you pick them up from other players and say, oh my gosh, I never thought of that one? Or do you do research like nowadays YouTube or anything like that, asking friends or so on and so forth? How do you find these strategies?
It's both. Sometimes you see patterns from other people that you try to incorporate. But sometimes, like I think it was Mason said, there is a Zen-like quality when you really get into the game that you it's like an instinct, you instinctually do things that work. You know, once you have like a skeleton of a pattern or a routine, you know, the more you play it, you get more comfortable with that routine, and then you can sort of veer into doing some other techniques that maybe you were forced to do when you had to adjust what you were originally going to do because of what the game was throwing at you. And sometimes it's also watching other people's patterns and trying them out, you know.
Yeah. Well, no, I didn't mean to interrupt. I'm very sorry. I just noticed that, like, both of you guys were doing that combo that involved using this, I'll just call it a crab and a fly.
Natural instinct because of the love I just happen to have for this particular game, which you can speak of, like, with Tetris or Millipede or maybe some of the games that are just close to your heart, you know?
Yeah. No, I dig that completely, man. I'm right there with you. I know, well, I mean, I'm not you, but I know what you're talking about. Thank you.
Well, it's funny. I'm gonna interrupt talking about finding the patterns and it being both ways. I know for us in the lounge, I mentioned that we picked up Zookeeper about a year ago. Having Xander and I having never played it, and I think Jace may be playing it years and years ago, so we hadn't played it.
I found it, and then I told Ash Birch about it. She played it once and beat me, and I was like, that's it.
Well, when we started playing, we were getting, you know, 30,000, and we were like, wow, look how great we're doing. And we didn't understand the actual concept of the game to jump multiple animals. And I think I was the first one that I just suddenly got a 250,000 point jump.
Yes.
And it just all the three of us, just our eyes just opened, and we were like, oh my gosh, this is how this game works.
It shot you up to like 600,000.
Yeah, we didn't, you know, at the time we were like, we'll keep the animals in the zoo. And we realized very quickly after that moment how the game would be unlocked from doing a strategy we hadn't even realized was a strategy and is the way you should be playing the game.
Late night zookeeper in the lounge.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Can't help it.
Yeah, sometimes we go till 4 a.m. or so playing that game. So I want to really quick just give a shout out to everybody just joining us from the front page of Twitch. You are joining us in our unfortunately laggy stream today, but there was an awesome Mario off, a Mario Brothers challenge between Stephen Kleisath and Stephen Boyer, both champions at this game, both reached over 1 million points live tonight. They played three games tonight. Stephen Boyer had 1.4 million. Stephen Kleisath, who we're speaking with now live, had 1.1 million. Stephen Boyer, I think, is still in the chat from what I can see, him sending some messages. If you guys have questions for these gamers, please get those questions in here. We've got Mason Kramer as well asking some questions up there in Lounge Live 1, giving some awesome insight to this whole experience. And some classic gaming fans, and I'm sure players out there in the chat have been tuning in. So we're happy to have them here. So, to brief the folks just tuning in, Stephen, could you give us a sort of insight into how this particular challenge came to be? Because as you said, you've never actually met Stephen Boyer in person. How did this sort of rivalry or competition, or how do you like to think of this? How did this come to pass?
It was just, I don't know, just an idea that sprung from the last Commonwealth this past November in Denver. I actually talked to Richie Knuckles about at the next Kongoff, if he could get a couple Mario Brothers cabinets, let's have a side event called Mario on. And he was receptive to the idea. And then just over the months since then, me and Stephen Boyer just periodically watch each other's streams. And, you know, we like to talk about Mario Brothers. We really like to talk about strategies and different techniques together from time to time on the phone, of course, or through text message, or, you know, besides just catching up in general and just talking about other stuff. But, and then probably not more than maybe 3 weeks to a month ago, you know, I basically was like, hey, why don't we stream it, you know, online? And then from there, we had talked to Kat Spira, and I'd also recently done an interview with a guy named Patrick Scott Patterson, who has a couple sites, and him and Kat are really good friends. And he'd actually done an article about me regarding Mario Brothers when I had broken 1 million a couple months back. But basically, me and Steven was receptive to the idea, and then we pitched it to, or we talked to Kat about it. And Kat knew Jennifer from the from your lounge.
Right, right. Of course.
She sort of got in touch with us, and we sort of told her the idea we had, and she was you guys were receptive to. And then here we are. So
that's great. I was going to ask you too about reaching 1 million points. So you both did tonight. How rare is that? How many times have you hit 1 million?
Stephen Boyer's hit it more times than I have. I've hit it probably at this point only. It's pretty sort of recent. I mean, I've hit it maybe because I just started getting back into playing the game probably within the last year.
Okay.
I have time periodically, so I've hit it probably, actually in the last 2 or 3 weeks, I've hit it 5 or 6 times. But the highest I've ever gotten to date for me is like 1.4 million.
1.4, yeah. and that's the fifth highest score. And
that's the current fifth highest score in the world, yeah. And then Stephen Boyer, I think his main score is a little higher than his arcade score, but it's like 2.1 million. I'm sure Steven can chime in and tell you.
Yeah, because for the way the Twin Galaxies records work is that they split it up between an arcade cabinet and an actual and a MAME. So you have settings and then you set the record based on those settings.
Yeah, they have different platforms. But on the we sort of made a Mario Brothers high score list with the assistance of some of the other top Mario Brothers players at the Donkey Kong Forum.
Right.
And when we meet up, we actually want to do a two-player when we finally meet up and maybe have some time to play it a little while.
So when you do meet this also, Stephen Boyer, when you do meet up, who takes point? Who's kind of the shot caller, do you think? Are you willing Stephen to kind of take a secondary role, or how would you work it out?
I'll be the Dwayne Wade, he can be the LeBron James. That's fine.
I see. Of course you go with a Florida team, so
No, it all depends, really. I mean, I'm sure it'll be a give and take one way. Whatever's more convenient for set board. And whoever gets to certain parts of the screen can think faster. And there's all kinds of variables.
Right, okay.
But I consider Mario Brothers one of the two-player games ever made. Joust is a really good one too. There's a couple others, but Mario Brothers is a great two-player game.
Yeah, well, that's
we can get this version of the MAME where you can actually play two players, even though you're in different parts of the country. And
we got to figure out how to make that happen. Absolutely. Stephen also mentioned in the chat, Stephen Boyer mentioned in the chat, Joust being a great two-player, as well as Bubble Bobble, which I would agree with. Bubble Bobble is one of the greatest two-player games.
They're good ones.
I think Tom Vadova's also got the world record on NES Bubble Bobble.
Man.
He seems to be all over the place, doesn't he, that Tom Vadova?
He's an NES killer. He has a lot of NES records. I think he got married, so he's settled down a little bit from
Tom's really one of my heroes, man. Tom's one of my heroes. He's a calculations master. I was really stoked to try to, like, beat a Tom Vadova score. Like, that's, like, made me happy. I don't know.
Well, that 4.6 million may be a record that it's going to be a while before someone breaks it, but it is possible.
Yeah, well, I bet it can be done. I mean, watching you guys has kind of made me, like, want to sit down and try this on MAME. I played the NES version. I actually played the NES version of this Mario Brothers against Tom Vadova and lost to him, but it was a cheap kind of loss. So maybe I'll be, I mean.
What you just said is the whole reason we did this tonight. So it's awesome to hear that other people want to take up the game, because that was the whole point of doing it.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's really to bring glory to the game, for people to acknowledge, like, really the creation of this game, how the creator just either got really lucky or he's a genius. Obviously, same guy did Donkey Kong, but it's quite a amazing game,
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good game, and there's a lot of subtle techniques, there's a lot of articulation in the movements, it's a good one. It's quasi-patternable, but you really have to freehand it too, and the clears, the random icicles, it's great, I love it. I mean, I'm familiar enough with it, having played the stripped-down NES port of it, that I'd like to jump onto the arcade. I got a chance to play it for like a minute one time, and then I had to leave, and you guys have inspired me. I want to get back into it. So thank you for that.
One tip I would give you when you take up this game, and Stephen Boyer would say this is the most paramount thing in practicing. If you can do this, you will get far in the game, and it's short jumping, doing the short jump. Like, when we jump on top of the pal and maybe divert from a fireball or one of the animals, it's like, if you're able to short jump on command, you'll go far in Mario Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
It's a technique called short jumping, where you just sort of jump sort of straight up, sort of angled, but you're not jumping all the way to the left or all the way to the right, which gets you in trouble.
I have a question for you about the gameplay of the arcade version. Is there still a safe spot? I noticed that when the fireballs appear, that appearing animation doesn't hurt you. Could you turn the extreme left or right hand side where the screen wraps around? Could you turn that into a safe spot and hide there for a while? At some risk, of course, but could you do it?
Oh yeah, no, there's safe spots. I did it a couple times.
Yeah.
Been here real quick because our numbers bumped up on there. There were over 1,000 people in here, and hopefully we still have you. And looks like maybe we bumped offline again. But anyway, I'm gonna talk to you anyway. What you missed tonight was really fantastic. We had a Mario off, and we are going to go to a commercial. We have enjoyed, in 5 minutes, we're going to go to a commercial and then finish out the night with probably some Infinite Crisis, so stick around. But what you missed was a great Mario off between Stephen Boyer and Stephen Kleisath, who are the number 3 and number 5 in the world, scoring-wise, on Mario Brothers, the classic arcade Mario Brothers. Could be your grandpa's. No, maybe your dad's. Your dad's Mario Brothers. We'll say that. both of them scored on one of the rounds over 1 million points. The world record right now is at 4 million. Stephen Boyer's best score is over 2, and Stephen Kleisath's is at 1.4. And so they showed us really how to play, a lot about fundamentals. We really are trying to do these kind of events here and there to really promote the arcade games. Because we get a lot of really great gaming on Twitch, from the MOBAs to the first-person shooters to some of the more RTS games and such. And so we want to help with the arcade scene. So if you have any last words, forgive the robo voice that we're having from Stephen Kleisath. And you know what? Just for these last 5 minutes, Stephen, if you wouldn't mind hanging up and signing in to one of the others, just so for the last 5 minutes we could really hear you clearly, any last words you said. We also have been joined by Mason Kramer, who's up in Lounge Live 1. He has a ton of world records as well. And it's been great having you, buddy. So Stephen Boyer does not have Skype, but he is there in the chat, and we're grateful to him and to Kat to bringing this to Jennifer's attention. We've got 2 minutes, so do you have any last words, Mr. Stephen Boyer or Mr. Stephen Kleisath, who is going to sign in here, hopefully, so he can make it in the 2 minutes that we have until we go to commercial?
I'm here, guys.
Oh, there he is. Great. Any last words for you? We've got just under 2 minutes.
Well, thanks, everybody who was able to view the stream tonight. We appreciate you guys having us and all the viewers that go to our personal Twitch pages regularly, and hopefully now new viewers because of this event. And we hope people will rediscover original Mario Brothers, take up the game, have fun with it. And we hope to be back here again with Mario Brothers and other classic arcade games when you guys will have us.
Well, we really enjoyed it. Thank you so much, Stephen. And the surprise, got 30 seconds. Mason, it was a good surprise to get you on and have such great insights. Have any thoughts?
I want to thank you guys for having me on and letting me say some stuff and talk with you guys. I really, really appreciate it. Thank you to both Stevens. You guys are great. You've inspired me to play the game, and I'll post some high scores later. Shameless plug, if you want to check me out, you can find me on Facebook, and my music is called Cowabunga Breakfast. You can find me on Bandcamp. If you like my stuff, you can listen to it.
We got 2 seconds. We got 2 seconds left. Thank you, guys. We'll catch you.
Isn't the point of the game to try to stay away from the bombs?
Ah! You're supposed to catch the bombs, don't miss.
Dude, oh my gosh! so sick of this. I'm glad they have this reset button.
Don't blame the game, John.
I'm not blaming the game. I'm just blaming everything that's surrounding the game. The stick, I rotate left, it goes right. I rotate right, it goes left.
Oh, don't blame the controller.
Well, what are you talking about? They made this back in 1980. They didn't know how to do lubricants for their dot matrix machines and stuff like, I don't even know.
The problem's not the controller, man. You know the saying, don't blame the player, blame the game? In video games, it's the reverse. You don't blame the game, blame the player.
No, that's not.
Okay. Dude, I'm seeing
your stupid squabblings are just messing me up. These old devices don't have the same lubricant or machine parts that our new controllers nowadays have, okay? It's just like, damn it! Gosh dang it, this is so stupid! This game sucks, Kaboom sucks, you suck, you're talking so much.
You said you could beat me. I told you to try. You asked advice from good friends, and I don't know why. Now you want to start it over, and you feel just like a new. You ran your mouth all day, now it just don't feel the same. Gotta blame it on something.
Gotta blame it on something.
Gotta blame it on something. Blame it on the game that was cheating, cheating. Blame it on the stick that went left, not right. Whatever you do, don't put the blame on you. Blame it on the game, yeah, yeah. You can blame it on the game. Should've told me you were sorry. Could've said you were wrong. But no.